It's 5 games in 4 nights as ESPN's cross-country bowl road trip continues. Last night in Orlando, it was the Reggie Ball Show as Georgia Tech raised the trophy in the Champ Sports Bowl. Tonight, the Journey West takes us to Mobile for the GMAC Bowl. Let the fireworks begin between Bowling Green and Memphis. Tomorrow, we head to Fort Worth and then Las Vegas. Ending in Honolulu on Christmas Eve, ESPN Bowl Road Trip, east to west and home for the holidays. And welcome everyone to Mobile, Alabama, the original home of Mardi Gras in the United States, where the revelry, the rejoicing, the moving and shaking is reaching a fever pitch.
Former MAC quarterbacks are now MACs of the NFL. Who's next? Bowling Green's Omar Jacobs? He put up some MAC-adocious numbers this year. Memphis, meanwhile, gonna man up with its man-child, DeAngelo Williams, the third leading rusher in the nation. The GMAC Bowl, where points are plentiful and defense is done. The hype hits the spotlight. It's Bowling Green, Memphis, next.
Today is the day. You can see me now.
If you can see me now.
No, you didn't get that. You didn't get that.
And hard to believe, but just a little over 90 minutes ago, it was clear and warm. But the torrential downpour has begun in earnest since that time. And this is the scene inside Ladd People's Stadium in Mobile, Alabama, the port city, where tonight we have what could be a high-scoring affair between Memphis and Bowling Green. Bowling Green coming out of the MAC, Memphis also at 8-3 out of Conference USA. A couple of teams playing in their second of back-to-back bowl games. And here come Bowling Green out of the MAC. Hello, everybody. I'm Mark Jones, along with Bob Davey, Holly Rowe down to the field from all of us at ESPN to all of you at home. Season's greetings, Bob. This is Ladd People's Stadium, where defenses come to die and offenses dance on their collective graves. We have two teams that can make that kind of matchup tonight.
Well, I'm going to start this off with a prediction, okay?
Go to it.
I know I'm not supposed to do that.
Go to it.
There's 28 bowl games. If the weather holds up tonight, I'm going to make a strong statement. This is going to be the highest scoring bowl game of all. The reason, both offenses spread, no huddle, very creative. Bowling Green likes to throw the football. Both of them score a lot of points. Bowling Green averages 43 points a game. They like a lot of five-receiver empty formations led by Omar Jacobs, the quarterback. 36 touchdowns, only 3 interceptions. First year as a starter, MAC Conference Offensive Player of the Year. When you talk about Memphis, a little more balanced out of their spread offense. Maybe one of the best running backs in the country, Mark, DeAngelo Williams. This guy's a player. 220 pounds, a legitimate 4.3 40. He's averaged over 240 yards rushing the last 2 games. It's a big if, but if the weather holds up, we won't have a shootout here tonight.
Well, it hasn't so far, but who knows which direction it's going to change. And DeAngelo Williams, maybe the best player that nobody has seen so far in the nation. Meanwhile, Bowling Green says, hey, we know they have a good game plan, but they can't stop us. More after this.
Welcome, everyone, back to a soaking wet Ladd People's Stadium in Mobile, Alabama. Fans sticking around, braving the weather. Let's go downstairs to our Holly Rowe. Holly, are you going to try and stay dry?
Well, it is pretty wet down here, guys. It has been raining torrentially before this ball game. But let me tell you what's going to happen, just in case of a lightning delay. There is some lightning in the area, and the officials say they're going to go by what's called a flash bang theory. If they see a flash of lightning, they will count 30 seconds or less. If the bang happens, they will delay this game at least 30 minutes. So both teams right now really anxious to get going and started because they don't want to delay. They're going to try to wait out this weather, guys, and kick it off.
All right, Holly, take care of yourself down there on the sidelines.
That sounds kind of an old school policy.
Flash
right
of bang, huh?
I remember a little kid growing up, we used to do that on the porch. You know, you can see the lightning and then count or hear the bang. I thought meteorology had gone to a higher level than that by now.
I guess not. It's all about the wives' tale. Still, see the temperature, 61 degrees, a little bit of a wind, not much.
But the fans here braving the weather. As we said about 90 minutes ago, it was clear and beautiful here, but since that time, the rain started. Well, Bowling Green won the toss, deferring to the second half. Memphis will receive. Memphis with some good team speed. They come into this game 8-3. Bowling Green as well at 8-3. Back deep for the Tigers, it's Chris Kelly.
Mark, the good thing, it's raining hard, as you can see right there, but the wind, not a big factor yet.
Kendis Cole joins Kelly back there. The kick goes through the back of the end zone. And Memphis will start off on its own 20-yard line. Danny Winbrine is the starting quarterback, a 6'1 senior, holds virtually every passing record in Memphis's school history. He's been the starter of the team since the middle of the 2001 season. And they'll start off, as I mentioned, on the 20-yard line. There's a look at Winbrine, 6'1, 222 pounds.
He is like the point guard in this offense. You are going to see a multitude of formations, a lot of window dressing. And how about this first formation we see, Mark?
Looking at, six receivers on this one. And they run it. They spread the field out and give it to DeAngelo Williams. And Williams with a nice gain out beyond the 25-yard line. As tonight's starting lineups are brought to you by Zales. Record for touchdown receptions. This offensive line, Bob, gave up only 5 sacks all year long. It's second down and 5. They hand it off once again to Williams, and Williams brought down behind the line of scrimmage by Jovan Burks, the 6'1 redshirt senior. Let's take a look at the defensive front. Bowling Green, Crosley, one of the guys to watch.
And really, these two defensive ends, Devin Parks, who started last year as a freshman, and Mitchell Crosley, Javon Burks, the outside linebacker, their leading tackler. And this secondary will be under duress because Danny Winbrine, as you see him right here, looking over to the sidelines to get the check. He can throw the football, Mark, his fourth year as a starter in this offense.
On third down and 6, tempo going to be very important to watch for both teams in this game. Out of the backfield, it's complete. But DeAngelo Williams going to be stopped up short of the first down at about the 27-yard line. So looks like the Bowling Green defense will hold on its first offensive, defensive series.
Mark, something to look for right off the bat here on fourth down. Memphis keeps Danny Winbrine in the game, their quarterback slash punter. They like the rugby rollout style punt. They faked 3 punts this year. All 3 of them have been successful.
Rolls out to his left and boots it. Gets off a pretty decent punt. It's a stick and stay job at the 41-yard line, and the Falcons going to have good starting field position for the opening drive of the ball game for them. And that's where their quarterback, the 6'4 redshirt sophomore Omar Jacobs, will take over. Keep an eye on this young man from Delray Beach, Florida. He was the MAC Offensive Player of the Year. A great first year as a first-year starting quarterback.
And they will spread the field. You see right here, they come out in a 4 wide receiver set. And P.J. Pope, the tailback back here in the backfield, is really, Mark, like the 5th. Wide receiver. They throw the football.
Going to be some interesting matchups, Bob, in that secondary. And Jolie Dunn's defense with an interesting formation and base defense that they play in. First down and 10 for Bowling Green from their own 41. Handoff goes to P.J. Pope. Pope made all-conference in the MAC this year. He makes it out to the 45, gaining about 4. Marcus West. There's a look at the skill positions. Pope, who got the carry. Sharon had a breakout year as a wide receiver.
And they list the tight end as a starter, Todd DeBacco, but he won't be in there much. This offensive line, led by the senior Scott Murkowski at center. Great job with the shotgun snaps because they are in the shotgun 99% of the time.
Going to be second down and about 6 to go.
Both teams, no huddle. Both teams check from the sidelines as you see the quarterback, Omar Jacobs, look over to get the check.
Jacobs rolling out to his left. Drills one almost picked off by number 8. That's not Vogel. It's going to be third down and about 6 to go.
And this Memphis defense, a 3-3-5 alignment. The nose guard, Albert Means, transfer from Alabama. The three linebackers led by Tim Goodwell. And this secondary will be tested, particularly the corners, Dustin Lopez and Tristan Thomas, because Memphis will play man-to-man coverage a high percentage of time.
It's a defense that, frankly, hasn't performed all that well against the pass this year. And they're going to be under big pressure tonight from Jacobs at quarterback. Third down and six. That's Cole Magner in motion. Jacobs looking downfield, down the middle. Complete. To the 22-yard line, it's Steve Sanders, who has really developed into a good all-round receiver this year. A pickup of 33 yards. It's first down and 10. Jacobs really delivered it, Bob.
And that time, Memphis plays three deep, zone coverage, great pass protection, and a great throw right there. Steve Sanders down through the middle of that zone.
Gives them a first down and 10 at the 22. Once again, you see Jacobs looking over to the sideline. Both teams will do that throughout the course of the evening, both offenses.
And Bowling Green in an unbalanced trips formation with the tight end over here to the side of the trips.
They toss it to Pope. Sorry, Bob. And Pope tries to get to the edge. Is cut off at the 20-yard line by Wesley Smith. Greg Brandon is 19-6 overall as the BGSU head coach. A guy that really made his impressions and earned his philosophies working as an assistant at Northwestern. And that's kind of where this offense has evolved into, right, Bob?
You're right. A lot of people have copycatted, truthfully, what Rich Rodriguez did at Tulane and then Clemson and now West Virginia, and also what Northwestern did with their spread. But Northwestern got it from Rich Rodriguez. So just about everybody in the country now, some form of spread offense. These two teams tonight are two of the best, though.
On second down and seven, heat coming on Jacobs. Got it off in time. No flag, and it's incomplete in the end zone. Intended for Charles Sharon. That's the deep threat for BGSU. Meanwhile, Tommy West is Greg Brandon's counterpart on the other side of the field. Tommy West making news recently, had his contract extended through the year 2009, bringing his average salary to $800,000. He's really done a nice job with this program in his fourth season at the helm.
And two straight bowl games. Last year they beat North Texas in the New Orleans Bowl.
Third down and seven now for Bowling Green. Jacobs has a man for the first down and then some, down to the 7-yard line. That was Hawkins on the catch. He was working on Dustin Lopez, and it'll be first down and goal to go for Bowling Green.
And you see the dilemma Joe Lee Dunn has as we see the off coverage up here at the top with Dustin Lopez, the corner. Undersized corners, way too much cushion right there in the zone defense. James Hawkins with the reception. And this defense for Memphis has struggled all year long.
Joely Dunn already looking a little bit beleaguered here on the first drive of the game for Bowling Green. It's Pope running it inside. Brought down just shy of the end zone, about a foot away. E.J. Pope, the 5'9 junior. Last year kind of went under the radar a little bit, but this season guys looking out for him, but he still responded with a very productive year.
And we talk about this Bowling Green offense being high-powered. They're also a quick-start offense. They've scored in the last six games in the first drive of the game, and they've put up unbelievable numbers in the first half of football games.
A handoff. Nothing happening up front. Good hit that time by Tim Goodwell on Pope. It'll be third down and goal to go.
We talk about first half statistics, Mark. I've never heard of some of these statistics. Bowling Green, 551 yards and 49 points against Western Michigan in the first half. 442 yards and 42 points in the first half against Temple.
Wow. Well, this is the ninth play of the drive for Bowling Green. Jacobs out of the shotgun. Actually, it's Pope on the direct snap, and he got in. Jacobs was lined up out as a receiver, and Pope took the direct snap and scored it.
Seven straight games. Bowling Green scores with the opening drive, and P.J. Pope lines up as the tailback with Omar Jacobs at receiver, and they've done a lot of it this year, Mark.
So Bowling Green, as you mentioned, Bob, they have a propensity to march it down the field and score early, and Pope with his 14th rushing touchdown on the season, 28th of his career. And the Falcons out to a 7-0 lead.
And we talk about this formation with Pope at quarterback. This is no surprise to Memphis, because Bowling Green has done a lot of this. The direct snap and good leg drive, good strength right there by P.J. Pope.
P.J. Pope getting it done. We'll be back after this. It's a long way from Bowling Green, Ohio, to Mobile, Alabama, but a bunch of fans have made the trip for the Falcons, and boy, they like what they see so far. Bob, I'm not going to say that it looked easy, but it looked easy.
Well, we talked about Bowling Green's quick strike offense as we look at those first quarter statistics, but on the other side, in Memphis's three losses, they've given up an average of 46 points a game.
Oh, the onside kick. It's still loose, and Bowling Green may have gotten it back. They might have caught the Tigers napping. Swisham with the onside kick, and great Brandon rolls the dice and says, first down, way to go, guys.
In the open, I want to go back to my prediction of the 28 bowl games. This could be the highest scoring. Here's the little middle onside kick. Great job of execution by Bowling Green. And as long as that ball goes 10 yards, you are allowed to block the Memphis player and keep him from trying to recover the ball. As long as it goes 10 yards, it is a live football.
Sean Swisham, the kicker, Bob, appeared to be the first guy to touch it, too. Pretty good hustle. Heads up play by the Falcons. They've got it back first down and 10 at their own 48. Jacobs under the center for the first time in the ball game. Little bubble screen. It's complete to McGrady. And McGrady makes it down into Memphis territory at the 46-yard line.
Bowling Green does not run the football as much as they ran it last year. But really, those screen passes are really part of the run game. Just a little simple throw behind the line of scrimmage, and you will see a lot of screens all night long from this Bowling Green offense.
Jacobs once again under the center, eschewing the shotgun on second down and 5. Handed off to Pope. Nice gap up the middle. P.J. all the way down to the 18-yard line. Pope getting his giddy up on. Finally brought down by Quinton McCray. A pickup of 29 yards. And that offense is just making incisions in that defensive front.
Memphis, a three-man front with three down guys, so there's some gaps up there. You see Omar Jacobs under the center, not in the shotgun. They just hand the ball right off here to P.J. Pope, straight ahead. Some missed tackles.
First down and 10, Jacobs was looking for the screen back the other way to the field and threw it away at the 21-yard line. Albert Means was the closest one to it. Let's talk about Jacobs a little bit. Some gaudy statistics this season. 36 touchdown passes against just 3 interceptions. He was voted the MAC Offensive Player of the Year in starting all 11 games. They knew that he was going to be something special, Bob, when in the first game of the season against the Oklahoma Sooners, he put up a respectable 24 points on the board in the loss.
And keep in mind, last year he only threw 28 passes all year. This year he's thrown 418 passes. So first year as a starter.
And he goes into the end zone. Touchdown! What a catch! Charles Sharon, tippy-toe touchdown. Great concentration on the play by Sharon. His 14th touchdown catch this season. And Omar Jacobs does it again, Bob.
Charles Sharon, the big play receiver, a little post corner route right there on Dustin Lopez. And what an accurate throw by Omar Jacobs.
with 9:37 to go. Omar, just call him Omarvelous. Ooh, was it in?
Big Ten officials, but no replay, Mark.
It's on the board and it's not coming off.
ESPN's presentation of the 2004 GMAC Bowl. Brought to you by GMAC, the financial services people from General Motors. And in part by Aflac. Ask about it at work. And the United States Marine Corps. The few, the proud, the Marines.
Omar Jacobs with his 37th touchdown pass this season against just three interceptions. But was this in bounds, Bob?
And keep in mind, in the Big Ten, they have instant replay. Ooh. I think the toe is on the line. And we're going to get a chance to look at that again. Big Ten officials here tonight, but no instant replay because obviously it's not a Big Ten game. I thought his toe was on the white line, but it has to be indisputable video evidence right here. That toe, to me, is on the line. But if we let it roll, you're going to see some white stuff at the end fly up. Doesn't matter, Mark. It's 14-0, and what a throw by Omar Jacobs.
He has caught fire in the damp rain here. Shows you why they think so much of him at Bowling Green. But the question begs now, can Danny Wimprine counter? Here he is. First and 10, coming back the other way. Completes the pass at the 25-yard line to Avery. And let's go downstairs to Holly.
Guys, ironically, I was talking with one of the Big Ten officials here tonight before the game, and he said they were all set to have a proposal to the NCAA to have instant replay in the bowl games. Most importantly, the Orange Bowl National Championship game. They were going to fly in their whole crew and set it up, but the NCAA quickly shot down that. So no instant replay in bowl games this year, but the Big Ten wanted it.
Boy, that's an interesting fact. Williams running for the first down out beyond the 35. The idea about having instant replay. You don't want to have a situation, Bob, like Miami, Ohio State a couple years ago, where the official some feel really blew the call that cost the Hurricanes the title.
I agree, and the NCAA made a decision not to have it in the Orange Bowl. That doesn't mean they made the right decision. To me, there's no question. I mean, it's a no-brainer, and most conferences next year, Mark, or within the next 2 years, they will be going to instant replay because it was a huge success, in my opinion, and I know in yours, your opinion, in the Big Ten.
I don't think there's any doubt about that. Meanwhile, Williams running it again. The last time he picked up 11, this time about 5, out to the 40-yard line. That's a young man that has to get on track. They have their hopes pinned on him. He led the NCAA in scoring this year, and he averaged 166 yards rushing per game. That's third best in the country.
And bigger than you think. I mean, this guy has 222 pounds, and he is packed. Look at those calves. Those are the kind you've been working on at Gold's Gym on that little calf machine.
Can't get those on the treadmill either, Bob. Second down and 6. The pass is complete to one of the huge, rangy, strong receivers. Close to a first down. Practor that time made the catch. Practor along with Tavares Gideon. A nice tandem of receivers for Tommy West.
And you see the similarities in these two spread offenses. The only difference, Memphis likes to run it a little more with DeAngelo Williams. But both teams love screen passes.
That was a pickup of 8. First down out near midfield at the 49. Receiver formation, they hand it off to Williams. DeAngelo is D1. Look at that run with a first down at the 33-yard line, and he's ready to pump up the volume. He picked up 18 that time. 5'10 junior could be playing his last game for Memphis.
The first thing you're going to see, some window dressing on the play with the little motion as we let it roll right here. You're going to see the motion across and watch him just break down the outside linebacker, Pipkew, right there. That was a great run by DeAngelo Williams.
Bob, we saw Bowling Green doing it earlier. Now we see Danny Wimprine looking over to the sidelines for the audible and the call. On first down and 10. And he drops it. Wimprine pounces on the loose ball back at the 43-yard line. And you would have to think that the wet ball had something to do with that one.
And we talk about, as we look at Danny Wimprine right here, this guy's 225 pounds. He is the point guard of this Memphis offense. And I love this guy, Mark. 4 years out of New Orleans, JT Curtis won back-to-back state championships while he was at JT Curtis. 4-year starter at Memphis. Reminds you of Brett Favre now. Yeah. He really does.
He really has that linebacker mentality that they talk about. Not averse to going into the weight room and throwing up some iron with the defensive backs and linebackers. Going downtown, has a man in the middle of the field. Found himself in behind the secondary, and it was an easy six.
And both defensive coordinators better pray for wind and rain, Mark, because that's the only chance of slowing down these two offenses.
But Doucette, his second touchdown catch this season, the third of his career, and for Wimprine, his 78th career touchdown pass. And just when it looked like Memphis might be letting go of the rope a little bit, they fight back and respond offensively behind their senior quarterback, who holds most of the school records passing. Here's why.
And again, the play action fake, and Doucette, the tight end, right down the seam, and a great effort right here of getting in the end zone.
Doucette can do. We'll be back with more after this.
Tigers by 7. We are here with the president of GMAC, Eric Feldstein. And Eric, why is it important for your company to be involved in this great bowl game?
GMAC is delighted to sponsor this bowl game, because for us, this is really much more than just a football game. This is our community outreach program. We, through the bowl, reach out to many underprivileged kids. We set up camps for fatherless boys. We set up scholarship programs. This is GMAC's way of giving back to the community.
All right, and GMAC has continued their commitment.
We've signed up till 2008. We want to thank the folks in Mobile for hosting us. Thanks for letting us put our name on your bowl. Thank you.
All right, thank you very much. Mark?
All right, Holly, and I want to get back here because the gumbo is unparalleled. The gumbo. I saw you destroy a bowl.
I thought you were going to come with GMAC, what a great bowl, which it is. How this city has embraced it.
Sure has.
Mike Gottfried has started this thing, and how it's just
the parade that the GMAC people had yesterday.
Yeah, but don't go.
You were the star of the parade.
I know, but you came back with gumbo. I mean, you can have a little broader spectrum of what makes this bowl special, right?
It's all part of the atmosphere. GMAC lays the table out there, and this is Lane coming back on the kickoff return. Lane all the way out to the 32. Let's take one more look at the touchdown catch. More impressively, the run.
And anytime you can run the ball, it sets up play action. Watch Wimprine with the play action, but watch the safety. He's going to jump up and play run, and Doucette is going to run right by him down the field. Fake of the run, the safety jumps up, and Doucette with his 10th catch of the year. But when you can run the football, safeties have to respect the run with a guy like DeAngelo Williams back there. And Wimprine, he knows this is going to be a shootout, Mark. He loves it.
How important was that touchdown to get something on the board for them, huh? First down and 10, Jacobs now. Completes it to Sharon. Boy, Sharon turned around and the ball was right there in his arms. A first down and 10 on Memphis' side of midfield at the 48.
And you have to look at Omar Jacobs' release. He really throws it like he's throwing a dart. Watch how quick that ball comes out. Doesn't take the football back at all. Not your prototypical dropback style release, but he's extremely accurate. When you first watch him throw it, you're not sure he's a great passer, but the more you watch it, you see he's really accurate.
They picked up 20 yards on that one. They take the reverse and give it to Pope up the middle. He got about 3 or 4 down to the 42-yard line. Talking about Jacobs coming into this ball game, and speaking of Memphis's defense, he says, I'm sure they've got a good game plan, but frankly, I don't think they can stop us.
They're licking their chops because Memphis has struggled on defense, and Memphis is a 3-3-5 set that plays a lot of man-to-man coverage. They put those corners out there on their own. And Jacobs, you look at these stats, 335 yards a game passing, second in the NCAA. He wants a piece of this Memphis pass defense.
Memphis 111th out of 117. And Jolie Dunn has used that kind of unorthodox 3-3-5 alignment since his days at Mississippi State coaching with Jackie Sherrill.
And you have to appreciate the fact that he's stubborn and he wants to continue his play, his scheme, but you have to question his stubbornness because he really doesn't have man-to-man coverage corners. They don't have great blitzers, but he continues to blitz and play man-to-man. So at some point, are you giving your players the best chance to be successful by continuing to be a high-risk defense?
And Sharon has already had a pretty good day against Dustin Lopez, number 26 right there. Thanks, Bush. Jacobs on the toss, on the option. Nothing happening for P.J. Pope. First down and 10. What kinds of... First down and 10.
Surprisingly, Bowling Green not in the empty set yet where they take P.J. Pope and align him as a wide receiver. But a lot of this 3-by-1, three receivers on one side of the field set.
And there's a look at Pope once again. Stopped up near the line of scrimmage. If the secondary can't do it, you would think the responsibility would fall on those guys up front. And Albert Means, one of those people, along with Rubio Phillips. There he is, number 99. Those of the ball resting now at the 36-yard line with 5:15 to go. Jacobs now working out of the shotgun. Incomplete by inches, intended once again for Sharon. That's the guy that stretches the defense.
Again, we see man-to-man coverage, and again, the opportunity for a big play as Charles Sharon runs by Tristan Thomas, number 9.
And now we're looking at a 3rd down and 9. Jacobs passing is 5 for 9. Total of 89 yards. Little heat coming on Jacobs and he fires complete. And this is going to be another touchdown to Sharon. He toasted Thomas that time. A 36-yard touchdown catch and run by Charles Sherry.
And Jolie Dunn told us that Tristan Thomas had struggled all week in practice. It really has baffled him. The kid's lost a lot of confidence. He said if he gets beat early, he's going to be out of the football game. But again, Mark, if you don't have great coverage corners, why do you put them one-on-one against talented wide receivers? It's not going to work.
The extra point is good. And Bowling Green now leading by a score of 21-7. And to think that Charles Sharon came into the program at Bowling Green, a 155-pound receiver, they've made him a lot stronger and faster. The Falcons soaring high right now from Ladd People Stadium. More after this. Back to Mobile, Alabama. This was the scene last night, heading down Government Street, and that was the full. There's Holly Rowe throwing out. Look at that arm, Holly Rowe with the beads. She barely made the front row, Bob. What's up with that?
Bob Davies. We had a lot of fun out there on that play last night. People get excited about those beads and those little moon pies you throw out.
I saw you keep a couple, Bob. Right now, Bowling Green having their way offensively. Memphis
answered last time with the ball. We'll see if they can do it again as Danny Wimprine found his tight end, John Doucette, for a touchdown. They're going to start this one off on their own 20-yard line. And really has been an exceptional few days here in Mobile, Alabama. The GMAC people, Mike Gottfried, one of the organizers, and the rest of the people here have done a fabulous job with their cordial atmosphere, making us all feel at home. And despite the weather, we've had a great time.
And Steve Spurrier, the guest speaker yesterday at the luncheon, probably 1,000 people there. I hope he's watching because he's enjoying this football game right now. College football's changed a little bit, even though he's only been gone 3 years. I mean, it's all spread offense, and everybody's throwing the ball.
First down and 10. This is DeAngelo Williams running it. Got about 4. Near the 24-yard line, Mike Thaler made the stop on the play. DeAngelo Williams, for all of his talent, extremely humble. In fact, as a freshman, that's right, as a freshman, he's a junior now, as a freshman, for every post-game news conference, he would bring his offensive linemen into the conference with him to make sure that they shared in the credit.
And an interesting story from Wynn, Arkansas, the number one back in the state of Arkansas. Huge recruiting battle between the Razorbacks and Memphis. Goes to Memphis. Arkansas fans are still upset about that.
A little bit ugly. Wimprine eluding harm's way and throws it out of bounds at the 40-yard line. It'll be third down and about 5 to go for the Tigers. DeAngelo Williams has rewritten the record book.
And this is something they talked to DeAngelo Williams about when they recruited him. Come to Memphis, set all the records, and that's something we're going to talk to DeAngelo Williams about, Mark, to try to keep DeAngelo Williams, to get him to come back for his senior year. Make no mistake, he is Memphis's number one recruit right now for next year.
That last pass was the first incompletion by Wimprine tonight. Third down and 5. Little receiver screen complete. And a first down to Scott. Ryan Scott out near the 40-yard line. These offenses really look similar, don't they, Bob? Look at some of the things they do, those receiver screens.
And you love the wide receiver screens because, as you know, as long as the ball is thrown behind the line of scrimmage, receivers are allowed to block downfield. Watch Maurice Avery right here, who was a quarterback out of high school. Excellent lead block. And Ryan Scott converts the third down.
There's DeAngelo Williams. Got about 2.5 on first down. And for more on the recruiting of DeAngelo, let's go downstairs to Holly.
Well, guys, as you know, it is the heart of recruiting season right now for college football. But unbelievably, Memphis's top coach, Tommy West, said, our biggest recruit is a guy we already have on our team. They are trying to keep DeAngelo Williams. They want him to stay his senior season. They said there's still a lot he has left to accomplish. They're now showing him the NCAA record books and saying he could set his eyes on those. He also hasn't been a team captain. They want him to consider that. So, guys, they're putting a full court press on this young man to hopefully keep him in Memphis Blue next year.
And that's going to be one of their toughest, maybe their toughest recruiting job. The pass complete, but down immediately, the 42. That was Pratcher, but they can show him the record book, but if he sees the dollars as the per the projections.
And you look at this right here in talking to Mel Kiper. Obviously, DeAngelo Williams, a junior, but he is in the same category as Cedric Benson, Ronnie Brown, Carnell Williams, J.J. Arrington. What you love about him, he can block, he can catch. They use him a lot in the empty formation. You see him right here, actually aligned as a wide receiver. So he's 220 pounds, he's the fastest guy on the team, and he can do a lot of things.
Third down and 12. We need him to get a first down here. Wimprine, that's going to be incomplete at midfield. Fourth down coming up. The wires seem to be crossed as Michael Crossley was applying the pressure on the play from his defensive end spot. And it'll be fourth down and 12. Wimprine, the punter, stays in for Memphis.
And every time Bowling Green gets a stop, obviously, it's a chance for Bowling Green's offense to get another score. And watch this creative punt formation. Wimprine will roll to his left. He's a left-footed punter, but also the ability to fake it.
A little rugby-style boot again. Gets a fortuitous roll all the way down to the 33-yard line. And don't forget, folks, that tomorrow night, two more bowl games for you on ESPN.
Plains Capital Fort Worth Bowl featuring Marshall, also out of the MAC, against Cincinnati from Conference USA. That's at 6:30 p.m. Eastern Time. Then the Pioneer Pure Vision Las Vegas Bowl featuring Wyoming against UCLA at 9:45 Eastern on ESPN and ESPN HD. Well, cheerleaders a little bit rain-soaked down there, and the rain wreaking havoc with our communications up here. You may hear some strange murmurings and mutterings over our microphones, Bob, but I know we usually mutter sometimes. Well, I do, but some of that tonight I can disclaim, saying that it's caused by the weather and some of the havoc that it's wreaking on our systems here. First down and 10 as Pope carries it right between the tackles to the 34, and let's take a look inside Bob Davies' lab, Football 101.
And we talk about sometimes we make it a little more complicated than it needs to be. Against this spread offense, forget about all this. You have five blockers for six blitzers, but it's one-on-one, five-on-five with these DBs and these wide receivers in Joe Lee Dunn's style defense, and it's really like basketball. There you see the five wide receivers, including the running back P.J. Pope, and these five defensive backs for Memphis. They have to line up and play man-to-man, so it really is basketball on grass, Mark.
Right now, Charles Sharon is dusting Dustin Lopez. That is the matchup that is killing Memphis right now. This is Magner out near the 42-yard line working on Carlton Baker. Bo Magner, who last year was a starter on the second half of the season for the basketball team for the Falcons.
And the reason they send Cole Magner in motion so much, he has a hard time beating press man-to-man coverage with the DB right up on his nose. So you'll see him in motion from one side of the formation to the other because it's hard to play press man. And he's got a haircut since the last time.
It was a lot longer last year. That long, flowing blonde mane coming out the back of his helmet, no more. On third down and one now for Bowling Green.
Again, an unbalanced trips formation. Three wide receivers to one side. Quarterback run with Omar Jacobs.
And Jacobs got stuffed at the 40-yard line by Goodwill. He was more than good enough that time. And it'll be fourth down for the Falcons. Tim Goodwill telling Omar Jacobs, got you that time.
Mark, now watch the chess game continue. Cole Magner, the receiver, will line up as the punter in Bowling Green's formation. They had worked on this in preseason camp. He broke his toe. They haven't been able to use it all year, but he will be the punter, a lot like Danny Wimprine from Memphis.
Interesting, Bob. Mark it down. That was the first stop of the ball game for the Memphis defense. The Tigers showing their fangs a little bit, and it comes at the end of the first quarter. A controversial touchdown catch, but nothing controversial about the other two from Charles Sharon. The Falcons with the lead when we come back to Ladd Peoples in Mobile, Alabama. And welcome back, everyone, to the sixth edition of the GMAC Bowl in Mobile, Alabama, as we get ready for the start of the second quarter. Fans here are bundling up. Some of the revelers here watching Memphis. It's Magner, the punter. Nice snap and heel kick in rugby style as well. That's in vogue, but this doesn't go that far. It's going to be marked probably around the 40-yard line. He is kicking into the stiff wind now, as Memphis will have the wind at their back here in the second period of play. Just a 19-yard punt by Cole Magner.
There's that hair. I think it was just a little bit wet, Mark. And what an interesting guy. You mentioned from Palmer, Alaska. Greg Brandon was actually coaching at Colorado at the time he came out of high school. Greg Brandon then took the job at Bowling Green with Urban Meyer. They decided to bring him in. Thought it was a huge mistake at first. Wondered why they spent $600 on a plane ticket. Now the kid's been a huge success. And his younger brother is coming next year to play football.
He has committed, yeah, to sign and play for the Falcons. First down and 10 for Memphis.
You never knew there was a pipeline from Alaska to Bowling Green, a talent pipeline.
That one got by me, and all the recruiting services and books that I've read. No, I didn't. Take a little time out as take one of the injured players off the field for Bowling Green. Meanwhile, it's first down and 10 for Memphis. Let's go downstairs to Holly Rowe for more.
couple guys the delay is for the injury cart, as they will cart off backup linebacker for Bowling Green, Jamian Johnson. It appears he's done for the game. He has got a left knee injury that does not look good. He will be out for the rest of the game, which affects the depth of the Bowling Green linebacking group.
First down and 10, and the defense is already under a lot of pressure. Avery went in motion. Whitbrine downtown, complete. Touchdown, Chris Kelly. In one long strike, 60 yards. The Tigers back again.
And you mentioned Memphis had the advantage with the quarter change, with the win now at their back. And Danny Whitbrine again off the play action to Chris Kelly down the field, 60-yard touchdown.
Already 34 points on the board with the second quarter, one play old. And if you're a Memphis backer, you're thinking that this game looking very much like the Memphis-Louisville game, in which the Tigers unfortunately lost for their sake, but it was a 50-something to 40-something ball game, and that's the direction we're heading in tonight. Whitbrine with his second touchdown pass of the evening.
And again, we get play action. You're going to see Chris Kelly against quarters coverage. Just beats the safety, Keon Newsom, down the field for a 60-yard touchdown.
Throw that man some beads. He deserves them. More of that to come, we're sure. Welcome back, everyone, to Live People Stadium, the GMAC Bowl between Bowling Green and Memphis. And Kelly with another touchdown catch. The second tonight, pardon me, the second of the season.
You see Danny Whitbrine, a great play action passer, throws well on the run. Again, that touchdown set up by the ability of DeAngelo Williams back in that backfield. Keon Newsom, the safety, bit a little bit, and Chris Kelly got in behind him for the big touchdown.
Bob Davey, you've said at the top of the show that this is going to be the highest scoring bowl game of the season. Was that right?
That's exactly what I said.
Or was it ever? I can't remember.
No, I didn't say
sure?
ever. I said of the
but
28.
But check the tape.
I got the tape.
Okay.
28 bowl games will be the highest scoring bowl game of the year if the weather cooperates. Right now it's cooperated, much to the chagrin of the two defensive coordinators in this game.
And the Tigers kick it out of the back of the end zone. Remember, this is a bowl game that has seen the final score at one point 64-61. That's right, over 120 points just a few years ago. And now it's Omar Jacobs' turn to see if his offense can answer that last touchdown from Memphis. First down and 10 from their own 20-yard.
Talk about this bowl game. Mac has made such an impression on people across the country. Four MAC teams in bowl games, five Conference USA teams in bowl games. So nine teams, Mark, from those two leagues.
First down and 10. Jacobs gets rid of it quickly, and it's complete at the 24-yard line. One of his inside receivers. Pass complete to Sanders. 6'3", 201-pound redshirt junior was working on Collins that time.
We talk about Omar Jacobs coming out of high school, coming out of Florida. He was actually only offered by Buffalo, Florida Atlantic, and Florida A&M. Bowling Green, Urban Meyer comes in late. Visits on a Monday, Tuesday, ends up at Bowling Green. At first, he was disappointed that he wasn't more highly recruited.
He's showing the people that he deserves the accolades now. Completes that pass to Magner, who was working on Vogel that time. Well, Magner mentioned that last year he played on the basketball team. The year before that, he was a starter for the second half of the season on the Falcons basketball team. This year, though, is not going to play hoops at the end of the football season.
And amazingly, he has thrown five touchdown passes. So throwback to the quarterback, always a weapon against man-to-man coverage teams like Memphis.
Jacobs, meanwhile, 9 of 13 passing for 143 yards in the game. And he's blitzed, and they finally got to Omar Jacobs back at the 18-yard line. Quinton McQuarrie He was joined by Albert Meade. So Jolie Dunn dials up the heat. And Memphis registering its 22nd sack this year.
And Quentin McCrary with his fifth sack of the year. He by far is their best blitzer. You see him right there from the weak side on the blitz.
Jolie Dunn talked about blitzing a lot this game. I mean, almost every play, too.
Well, that's his number one thing, is to get after the quarterback.
Second down and 18. Magner in motion. Jacobs fires complete. Sanders out to the 42-yard line. And it's close to a first down. It looks like they're going to spot it in first down territory just beyond the 42. That's a pickup of 19 yards.
One of the tough things when you play for Jolie Dunn, if you're a safety, I want you to watch number 45, Wesley Smith. He will end up in man-to-man coverage right here on a wide receiver. That is a tough matchup for a big, tall, free safety like that, Mark. So again, it's basketball on grass in this game, five-on-five coverage. I'm not sure Memphis has the right personnel for this game.
We'll have to find something to slow down the hemorrhaging. The pass complete at the 47-yard line to Hawkins. So the one characteristic of this offense is that so many different receivers get to catch balls from Jacobs. You have Hawkins, you have McGrady, you have Magner, you have Sanders, Sharon, all of them very active receivers. And speaking of the receivers, you know, Jacobs, very salty. He's a little bit mad about his receivers being omitted from the All-MAC team. He said not even an honorable mention.
Well, no one that really has him upset, Scott Murkowski, the center, only second team All-MAC. Last year he was first team All-MAC, and the coaches are baffled by that.
This time they run behind that offensive line. Speaking of Murkowski, P.J. Polk got about four near the 40-yard line.
And we mentioned, Mark, Tristan Thomas, number nine, the corner from Memphis, who struggled all week, got beat in man-to-man coverage. He's now on the bench. Cameron Hussex, number seven, who started last year, is going to take his turn now, seeing if he can play man-to-man coverage on these wideouts from Bowling Green.
Looks like the rain is starting up again. But Jacobs has hit eight of his last nine passes. Magner in motion for the Falcons. Jacobs steps up. Nice move to the 40-yard line. And Jacobs down to the 34. Brought down by Rubio Phillips.
And Omar Jacobs, not as big of a threat as a runner as last year's quarterback, Josh Harris. They don't do as much of the quarterback runs, but he's athletic enough. Probably a 4.7 40. Needs to get that football tucked up in there a little tighter to his body. But they don't use him quite as much as a runner as they did Josh Harris last year.
Head coach Greg Brandon, in his second year, has had a lot of success with this program.
And what you see is what you get. Man-to-man coverage. Hold on if you're Memphis defensive backs.
The reverse to Magner, but there's a man waiting out there in space for him. Good play by David McNair, the defensive end. Strung that out and pushed Magner out of bounds short of the 30-yard line. Second down and about seven to go. The wind picking up as well.
Trust me, Jolie Dunn right now.
He likes
that
it.
Is the best part of your scheme right now, to see that flag just blowing stiff.
For the nature, the 12th man on defense. Jacobs working out of the shotgun this time. Charles Sharon already has two touchdown catches in this game.
And don't worry about Memphis disguising. They do not disguise coverages.
Top for Sanders, adjusts on it. Touchdown. Sanders torching Collins this time. And the beat goes on for Omar Jacobs. Jacking up that secondary in a huge way. That time a pass of 32 yards for the score.
And this is a dejected Memphis defense, and it should be. At some point, You better play some two deep coverage, help those corners, help those safeties. To play man-to-man coverage with no disguise, it's stealing right now for Bowling Green.
Swisham's extra point is good, and it's 28-14. Just under 10 minutes to go in the first half. Sanders right now against that secondary, a bit of a mismatch, catching his seventh touchdown of the season. That time in behind O.C. Collins. We'll be back with more after this.
ESPN's presentation of the 2004 GMAC Bowl. Brought to you by America Online. Want a better internet? You belong at America Online. SonicCare Elite. Stop rushing. Start SonicCare. And Zales, the Diamond Store.
And welcome back, everyone, to the Omar Jacobs, Danny Wimprine Fireworks Show here at Ladd People Stadium. Add that up, Bob. What is that? 42 points on the board with 9:54 to go in the first half. Bowling Green had 21 at the end of the first quarter. That tied the record with two other teams for the most points in the first quarter in bowl history. Jacobs has three touchdowns in his last 10 passes. It's a pretty good rate.
That's 39 touchdown passes with only three interceptions. That's as good as you can be.
Is that the system or the quarterback? Or a little of both?
No, I think obviously it is a little bit of both. They do a great job.
Memphis going to get an opportunity to return this. This is Cole. And Cole takes it out to the 28-yard line. Look at the all-time TD interception ratio leaders.
That's pretty good, isn't it?
David Carr. Recently, Sean King with Tulane. They had a great year, 11-0 that season. But 13-1 really trumps everybody.
And keep in mind, first year as a starter in this system, he was redshirted as a freshman, so he sat for 2 years watching Josh Harris. Really his third year in the system, you can see he has great confidence of where to put that football.
DeAngelo Williams right between the tackles, brought down beyond the 35 at the 36. DeAngelo Williams talked about his selfless play. He made up t-shirts last year for his offensive line. You know what it said on the back? It said, the Memphis Breakfast Club, making pancakes, heads and pancake blocks all day long. You gotta like that. He's a marketing major too,
yeah, I guess.
You'd
like that. He's one of those guys, everybody counts how many people in the box do we run, do we pass, do they have us outnumbered? It doesn't matter. Even if they have you outnumbered in the box, hand it to him.
Very studious and meticulous player. Second and two, gets the carry again. Up to the 37-yard line. Let's take a look at our game track, brought to you by Aspen Edge. It was raining touchdowns earlier. Chris Kelly had one of them, and Jacobs responding to Charles Sharon. He's got a pair. As Bowling Green leads 28-14, and Omar Jacobs continues to torch that secondary. That time, O.C. Collins got beaten on the play. The O.C. stood for outclassed. Oh, I'm on it tonight. It's Mobile. It's the revelry, man. It was the parade. You had me at the parade. First down and 10. Hey, the fans have really been enjoying themselves in spite of the weather. Working out of the shotgun. You can scramble a little bit. And that one almost a poor decision, broken up downfield by Keon Newsom. It was intended for Avery. Interesting that Newsom was beaten earlier in the ballgame for a touchdown, that time with a nice read, Bob, defensively.
And that time they really ran the same play they scored the touchdown on to do set the tight end down the seam off the play action. Again, he was open, but Wimprine could not find him.
So we've been talking about Jacobs a lot tonight, but Wimprine is 7 of 9 passing. A couple of touchdowns as well for 131 yards. And getting his check from the sidelines.
And they see man-to-man coverage at the top of the field.
A little screen pass. Doss made it out near the 40-yard line, about 5 yards short of the first down. Joseph Doss, a guy that they're really excited about, the freshman at 5'9".
And he will be the next DeAngelo Williams in this offense. 49 carries, 167 yards, 10 catches on the season for the freshman, Joseph Doss.
Third down and 7 to go for Memphis.
Empty formation with DeAngelo Williams as a wide receiver right here.
It was a year ago that Wint Brine was the MVP of their New Orleans bowl game, looking to recapture that form. Finding his target at the 49-yard line, complete. And it is near the first down. Tavarius Davis making the catch on the play, and it's first down and 10. They're going to give it to him.
And Danny Wint Brine, he can sling the football. And you see Tavarius Davis right here tore his ACL as a freshman. That's a great catch, particularly under these conditions with this wind and rain. And Mark, this will be a shootout.
Give it to DeAngelo Williams, has a blocker in front of him. And breaking tackles, DeAngelo finally brought down by Sales. Sales led the team in tackles for loss, but Williams again with a nice chunk of yardage.
And I had a chance to talk to their weight coach today. He is the fastest player on this Memphis football team at 222 pounds. And again, that leg strength, that lower body power.
And with that last run, Bob, he's just got over 4,000 yards rushing for his career at Memphis. Wint Brine keeps it. Makes it down to the 38-yard line. There's a look at his career numbers up to the minute. 4,003. The question that begs, will he be around to run the ball for the Tigers next year? He and his head coach, Tommy West, have been talking about it throughout the course of the last couple of weeks, getting all the pertinent information.
You know, this is his first bowl game. Last year did not play in the New Orleans Bowl because of an injury. Maybe his first and last bowl game here tonight in the GMAC.
Mel Kiper Jr. has him projected as one of the top four running backs in the country. The screen pass complete to Avery. Still on his feet. Avery set to go and blown it up. Touchdown, Memphis.
And I love that little throwback screen. They ran that play successfully against Louisville. And Mo Avery, who is a quarterback when he first came to Memphis.
Yeah, he went 38 yards for the score. His first touchdown catch of the season, the ninth of his career. He's made a nice transition, and with 6:41 to go in the first half.
And Mike Godfrey is sitting out in Las Vegas doing the Las Vegas Bowl tomorrow night. He's smiling because this is the way the GMAC Bowl is supposed to be. But this little play, a misdirection throwback screen, is a great little play. They bring Maurice Avery in motion, they throw him the screen, and you see his athleticism. This guy played basketball last year for John Calipari.
Mo
AC Bowl, Mark, a lot of points.
Mo Avery with Mo points. We'll be back in a minute. You know, so much history here in Mobile, Alabama. This is the USS Battleship Alabama, the ship commissioned in 1942, 680 feet long from bow to stern. I actually had a chance to take a tour of this battleship a couple of years ago. She earned 9 battle stars and shot down 22 enemy airplanes during World War II. And at a time like this, when our thoughts and prayers are with those who were victims yesterday in the attack in Iraq, we send out all the best to our forces overseas. 6:41 to go, and back here in Mobile, Alabama, the home of the original touchdown. That's the way it looks right now. Bowling Green has scored touchdowns on 4 of its 5 possessions in the ballgame. And once again, they'll start again on the 20-yard line. Time now for tonight's Aflac trivia question. Who is the only 2-time MVP of the GMAC Bowl? And in our production meeting last night, Bob, not to be immodest, but I actually got the answer on this one. That's a rarity.
Well,
you know this, right?
If you were that modest, you wouldn't have brought that up right now.
Oh, did I? I'll tell you the answer to that one in just a few. First down and 10.
Here we see the empty no back set with P.J. Pope lined up as a wide receiver. Memphis likes to blitz this, bringing six guys on the five blockers from Bowling Green, but it could be straight man-to-man coverage.
Jacobs surveying the sex situation. And they got to him for the second time tonight. Tim Goodwill. With 6.5 minutes to go in the half, the second sack of the night for the Tiger defense. Bob, during the break, we were talking, hey, what has Jolie Dunn do to stop the bleeding?
Well, I think when you play that much man-to-man, go ahead and blitz. You see right here, there's five offensive linemen. Jolie Dunn brought six guys, but look in the middle of this field. There's no help back there, so it's feast or famine. That time, the six rushers outnumbered the five blockers. That's an old ball coach right there. Now he's coached a bunch of football. Again, the empty formation. Again, it looks like straight man-to-man blitz.
Second and 19. This time Jacobs gets rid of it, incomplete. It'll be third and long. Intended for Cole Magner. He was working on Cameron Essex, and Charles Sharon a little bit shaken up, a little bit woozy after that last play. He's going to go to the sidelines. He's one of their vital weapons.
Again, the answer to the all-out blitz, the jailbreak screen, but because of press coverage by Essex, they couldn't get the ball out there. I asked Jolie Dunn yesterday, Mark, I said, if they give you 30 snaps of empty, how many snaps will you all-out blitz? He said 29. So he's coming after that empty now.
No breathers on defense for the Tigers. Third and 19. Jacobs hands it off to Pope. And he's brought down from behind. And Bob, for the first time tonight, you get the feeling that Bowling Green has been a little bit puzzled here defensively by Memphis. That's the first three and out of the evening for Jolie Dunn's defense.
And I think the wind is a factor. Both teams, Memphis now with the wind at their back, I think it's a definite factor. And Cole Magner's experiment as the punter is over now.
Back to more conventional means. Fry in a punt, averaging a little over 38 per punt on the season. Standing on his own goal line, a yard deep. Back deep, it's white. He watches it bounce. And Memphis is going to have very good starting field position, their best of the night. From the Bowling Green 46-yard line after that 31-yard punt. And Danny Wimprine, the senior, playing in his last game as a Memphis Tiger, trying to bring his team even at 28. He's got about 60 family members watching. That could be one of them. We'll be right back. Wide receiver Charles Sharon on the sidelines for Bowling Green. He came out on that last play. Rick Brandon, you hope that he gets back into the ballgame, but this is the best starting field position of the night for the Tigers. They run the reverse, but nothing happening that time. Joseph Dawes. And time now for the answer to our Aflac trivia question. Who's the only two-time MVP of the GMAC Bowl?
You know it's not a defensive player.
Heck no.
Rule any defensive player out of this.
Lord Byron, Leftwich, Marshall. 2001 and 2002, and one of those was that 64-61 victory against East Carolina. Game, boy, they trailed by over 30 points at halftime in that game. And that's the custom here.
The amazing thing about this Memphis offense, only five sacks all year given up.
Wimprine firing incomplete, intended for Tavares Gideon. It's going to be third down and 10. Let's go downstairs to Holly.
Well, guys, Charles Sharon was poked in the eye on that last play. He's come to the sideline. He was seen by the trainers, but the real telling thing is that he just told one of his teammates, man, I can't see. He's very frustrated right now. They're going to let him sit out, see if his vision will clear. But right now, Charles Sharon's saying he just can't see anything out of that one eye. Guys.
Well, that really kind of changes the equation for Bowling Green and Omar Jacobs if he can't go. Although they do have several different receivers that have caught a lot of balls this year. It's going to be third down and 10 to go for the Tigers after that holding call.
Mark, getting back to this Memphis offense, five sacks in 382 pass attempts.
Wow.
That's an amazing pass protection. And a lot of it has to do with Danny Wimprine and his ability to throw on the run to get away from the interior pass rush.
And they do have four seniors on that offensive line. Wimprine firing downfield, complete. And it's going to be a first down. His key guy so far, Chris Kelly, keeps the drive alive at the 31. They picked up 14 in that chunk of real estate.
And Danny Wimprine, some NFL people may think he's too short. He's about 6 foot, 225 pounds. Great catch right there by Kelly. But I'll tell you what, Mark, this guy may be a late round draft choice. He may be a free agent, but I think he will make an NFL team because of all the things he brings with leadership, studies the game, hard worker, won everywhere he's been. I really like this guy. He can flat throw the football.
He really came of age this year. Run the draw play. DeAngelo Williams get to the edge. That's where he is lethal. DeAngelo, D1, touchdown.
What you call a balanced offense. When you have a great quarterback and you have a great tailback, and watch this thing full speed, this kid can fly right here. That's 225 pounds, Mark. That's not a 175-pound back. That's 225 pounds, fastest kid on the team.
Extra point, good, Bob, and we are knotted at 28. I hate to tell Tommy West this, and I'm sure that he's heard this before, but I think there's a really, really good chance he may not come back. Look at those skills.
And he gets a great block downfield by Tavares Gideon, the wide receiver, and the shootout continues.
...56 points on the board, and plenty of football to go. Don't forget Christmas Eve at 8 Eastern. On ESPN, it's the Sheridan Hawaii Bowl, UAB against the Rainbow Warriors. That's at 8 Eastern time. Timmy Chang and crew. And remember, aloha means goodbye. On the island of Oahu, the gathering place it means in Hawaiian.
Got to know right now.
Talk.
Trev Alberts right now back in that studio.
Yeah.
Old defensive player.
Killing him.
It's killing him right now. And anybody, you know, I was a defensive coach up through the ranks. I mean, football has gone completely crazy, Mark. I mean, nobody can stop anybody.
Certainly the strong trend right now. And once again, the trend in this ball game, neither team able to return a kickoff. And in the last couple of series, Bob, Omar Jacobs and the Bowling Green offense has been stifled by whatever it is Jolie Dunn is doing defensively.
Well, we see Charles Sharon back in the game, but in the last series, Bowling Green came out with empty no backs. Jolie Dunn blitzed 6-on-5 pass protectors. Coming into this game, Bowling Green had only seen Memphis in 12 snaps of defense against empty. Now they know that it's a blitz-a-thon against the empty back set. So look for the ball going down the field.
Jacobs working out of the shotgun. Magner in motion. Has all day this time to throw. And fired incomplete, intended for Hawkins. It'll be second down and 10. Looked like he went through his entire progression and nobody was still open.
That time only a three-man rush by Jolie Dunn. That's one thing the 3-3-5 gives you the ability to do. Drop all eight into coverage. No headset. Nothing. He just dials them up from the sidelines.
Little unorthodox, huh?
Little unorthodox, old school football.
Second down and 10. Hawkins in motion. Almost intercepted in the middle of the field at the 30, intended for Sharon. And it's third down and 10. Dustin Lopez slipped on the play. And had he not slipped, he may have been able to make a play on the ball, and he comes up limping.
And that hurts because Dustin Lopez, the junior college corner who started half the year, comes out. That means Tristan Thomas, number 9, the corner, is back in the game, who was burnt early, has struggled all week in practice.
To go right at him if you're Jacobs?
Oh, I'd go right at him. The only question, that wind blowing right now in the face of Omar Jacobs.
Hawkins lines up against the aforementioned DB. And they come his way, but he overthrew him. It was intended, actually, for Sharon.
And you really do question why Bowling Green didn't throw the football on the other side of the field and go after Tristan Thomas, but it was straight man-to-man with Cameron Essex, no help, and really a good job of coverage right there by Essex. And again, Memphis a chance here late in the first half with the wind at their back to go ahead in this football game.
About half an hour ago, I thought I would never see back-to-back three and outs for Bowling Green. But that's the situation. Nate Bryan now for a second punt of the evening after the Cole Magner experiment came to an abrupt end.
Again, you look at this shield punt protection with three guys back by Bowling Green. This is kind of new and in vogue in college football this year as well.
And White gets off a nice spiral high back to the 36. This is White at the 40. Darren White with a 3-yard return after that 44-yard punt. And let's go back to the studio. Chris Fowler. Chris, what's up at halftime?
Oh, well, you guys, the defenses get a breather, Mark. We'll kick around the blue ribbon idea of how the BCS might pick the teams in the post-AP poll era. We'll talk about the Cincy Marshall game, Ken Gaduli go, and preview the Wyoming-UCLA game.
Yeah, Bob Davey asked if it bothered me that there was no defense. Absolutely, it's terrible, but I'll show you another game where if you're a defensive guy, there's no defense, Motor City Bowl.
I wonder what Bob Davey thinks about going to a blue ribbon panel to pick these BCS.
Is he on it?
He could be part of it. Yeah, it's back to you.
I know two guys that are on that blue ribbon panel. They're both sitting in that studio right now, the gurus of college football. So, Mark, with the AP now out of the BCS selection process, I know exactly where you go. It starts with Mark May and Trev Alberts. Because those guys can handle the heat now. They don't mind having that heat on.
They can take it.
And you know what? The way it's going right now, Nebraska, they're not going to be part of that BCS anyhow, so it's not going to be that controversial for Trev.
There's no conflict right
now. Pitt may be kind of a building program.
I can see that. I can see that. Williams on that last run lost a few. It's going to be second and 15. Crossley made the stop on the play. Memphis with an opportunity here to take its first lead of the game. Pressure coming. Wimpron. And it's going to be ruled incomplete. They tried to set up the screen coming back the other way. But once again, Mitchell Crossley, who is all MAC this year, with a nice bit of pressure on the quarterback. 6'3", 250-pound redshirt junior.
And we talked about only 5 sacks all year given up by Memphis defense, by the Memphis offense. And he's thinking right now, I don't want to give this football back to Omar Jacobs. I don't want to turn this football over. Maybe I'm going to run a draw right here to DeAngelo Williams.
Williams, along with Wimpron, looking over the sidelines for the call.
And Bowling Green in quarters coverage, 4 across, look for a deep out route on the sideline.
They dial up a little bit of heat downfield intended for Kelly. And it's 3 and out for the Tigers offensively, so failing to seize an opportunity to go ahead on the scoreboard. It'll be 4th and 15 coming up. Wimpron stays in for the punt. Bob, you talked about that unorthodox formation and punt protection, but what about the rugby kicks? We've seen a little bit more of that in college football this year, too.
And the great thing about that, Mark, it helps the punt protection because there's always the threat of fake. Obviously, you only punt to the side you're sprinting, so you're sprinting away from the protection. As we see Brandon Roberson in now, they're more conventional punter.
So both teams now going more conventional in the punting game. Sharon on the punt at the 27 and met immediately. Good special teams by Jermaine Chambers. And earlier yesterday, Holly spoke with the quarterback, Omar Jacobs.
What's it like looking at the national leaders in efficiency and seeing your name right up there?
That's a great accomplishment, knowing that's my first year starting, and it's just a big accomplishment just to know that I'm up there with the Heisman Trophy winner, and hopefully next year I can be at the Heisman Trophy winner inductions, and it's just a great accomplishment.
Certainly he's on the radar screen right now in terms of the Heisman consciousness, and usually it takes a year or two to get that far.
There's his radar screen right up there, that straight man-to-man coverage on one of those corners.
Pope running at that time, got about 6. P.J. Pope a guy who came to Bowling Green a couple of years ago, now a junior, 5'9", 216 pounds. Miami, Ohio, and Indiana got in on him a little bit too late. By that time, he was locked up with the Falcons.
They say he must maybe be their best all-round football player. Run, catch, block. Great job with pass protection.
He's even said, you know, I know that this is an offense where they sling it around throwing the ball, but running backs do get their share of carries and, more importantly, overall touches in this scheme. Second down and two. Jacobs downfield. A flag going to be called. It was intended for number 12, Steve Sanders, working on Vogel. See how our officials call this one.
Pass interference on the defense. 41. 15-yard penalty. Previous spot. Automatic. First down.
Mark Vogel's an interesting guy. He's torn his left ACL, Mark, three times. And I want you to watch right here, man-to-man coverage with no help. In other words, it's straight man-to-man. These three guys are man-to-man, and you're going to get a corner route right here. And he has inside leverage. And right here, I mean, that is tough. Great play with the left hand. It looked like the right hand may have grabbed right there. He has a hold of that jersey right there.
Good call. That's the first penalty of the ball game.
Again, a tough assignment for a safety, straight man-to-man coverage on a wide out.
Listen, gentle midfield. Oh. Magner, great catch to hang on to it at the 47-yard line. Cole Magner. Out of Alaska. Interesting, Bob. I spoke with him earlier. He says that he wants to open up, get this, a surfing shop.
In Bowling Green, Ohio?
Well, either in California or Alaska.
You know, I think his parents are actually moving to California. Yeah. Holly Rowe had that story last night. They're moving to California, so it starts to make sense now. That
got the,
sense.
The blonde hair, the surfer thing going?
Yeah.
Magner with some pretty good football skills. Nice to see him overcome adversity. Had a lot of injuries earlier in the season.
Again, you see him in motion to keep away from press coverage.
Jacobs, they move the pocket, and he finds his man. What an adjustment on the ball by Sanders. It was actually thrown behind him, and he got the first down. He was working on Wesley Smith, picking up 12.
And Omar Jacobs rolling to his left, as we know how difficult that is for a right-hand quarterback to throw back.
13-21, now 14-22.
Again, we see the empty formation. Look for straight blitzers. Some confusion right here on Memphis defense.
They paid a little bit of a price. Magner made it down to the 25-yard line. Boy, you see how important the tempo is, Bob. They got the ball to the line of scrimmage and went with it.
Great, great point. That's one thing about the no huddle. They lull you to sleep a little bit, getting the checks from the sideline, slow tempo. Then all of a sudden, they call it the Indy pace for the Indianapolis 500, and they snap it quick. That time, Memphis not alone.
As you look at Magner, one of a talented group of receivers for Bowling Green, Sanders already with over 100 yards receiving, the fifth time he's done that this year.
You have Magner again on the safety right here as the number three receiver.
Jacobs downfield. Complete down to the 12-yard line. His receivers really adjusting well on the ball. That time it was McGrady. Working on Essex, picking up 14 with under a minute to go in the half.
Again, Omar Jacobs on the run. You see that little slingshot delivery right there.
Jacobs took a hit.
He did take a hit. He's a big guy, though. That's 6'4", about 222 pounds right there.
Tim Goodwill came in there like a missile. And Bowling Green uses its first time out of the half. Memphis with its full complement of three remaining, 28's on the scoreboard. With 55 seconds to go here in the first half, I'm Mark Jones along with Bob Davey, Holly Rowe down in the field, the sixth edition of the GMAC Bowl, and once again, a high-scoring affair.
And we talked about Bowling Green in the first half, 49 points against Western Michigan, 42 points against Temple, 27 points against Toledo. I think they average about 29 points in the first half of football games. And interesting, talking to Joe Lee Dunn yesterday, it's really hard when you watch a team, Mark, on tape from another conference, because you just, it's hard to judge the talent level they have, the talent level that their opponents have. Joe Lee Dunn felt that they really had only played, I'm talking about Bowling Green, one legitimate defense all year in Oklahoma in the first game of the year. So it'd be interesting to talk to Joe Lee Dunn at halftime and see if he now realizes how good Bowling Green's offense is.
Don't forget, coming up,
I know right now.
This scoreboard.
Blue Ribbon Panel led by Mark May and Trev Albert.
Well, Jacobs a perfect 4-for-4 passing on this drive, hands it off. And an ill-advised decision that time with respect to the play call, as Washington made a nice play on the ball on Pope.
And we see that little sprint draw action. Memphis actually runs that play as well. Michigan State, Mark, if you remember back, ran that play against Michigan for a huge amount of yardage in the game in Ann Arbor. So another little part of the spread offense, that sprint drop.
Bowling Green using another one of its timeouts. You look at what Coach Greg Brandon has done here in his second year at Bowling Green, really building on the success that somebody that you're very familiar with, Bob, Urban Meyer, who got this thing really started and cranked up at Bowling Green. Folks, don't forget, tomorrow night, two more bowl games on ESPN. Flames Capital Fort Worth Bowl. Marshall against Cincinnati at 6:30 p.m. Eastern Time. Then it's the Pioneer Pure Vision Las Vegas Bowl. Wyoming against UCLA at 9:45 p.m. Eastern Time on ESPN and ESPN HD. For more information, log on to ESPN.com.
You know, the great thing about this bowl game, it's before Christmas. So these players now have the opportunity to go home, spend Christmas with their families.
Good.
And that is a huge, huge factor.
And for both teams, the extra practices of just being able to make it to a bowl game, very important. Especially for Memphis. They've got a lot of young guys that they need to fill holes next year. 28 seniors playing their final game for the Tigers tonight. Second and 15. Jacobs into the end zone. Incomplete. And broken up nicely by Tristan Thomas, a guy who has been victimized over and over tonight.
But it's good to see Tristan Thomas bounce back after a tough week of practice. Again, the little post route against man-to-man, the ball thrown behind right there, Charles Sharon. Well, that could have been a touchdown, Mark, if he gets that ball out in front of him.
Sets up a third down and 15. Touchdown array from tying the record for the most points and a half in a bowl game. Jacobs trying to write his name in the record book. What a catch! Touchdown! Oh, baby! Sanders got on the elevator. Keep the meter running.
And Steve Sanders at 6'3", about 205 pounds, 48 catches, and they say this guy next year will be an NFL player. Again, you see him just launch the ball up. Wow. That is a great effort over the top of Cameron Essex.
Well, you really can't fault Essex that much. I mean, that was just an outstanding play by Steve Sanders, who has really turned into a fine receiver this year. That's the fourth touchdown pass of the game for Jacobs. And Bowling Green now with a 7-point lead with 37 seconds to go in the half.
Again, these corners in this defense. That was a tremendous effort right there that time by the wide receiver. But again, when you're a one-in-the-middle team with your safety and a lot of man-to-man coverage, Mark, those corners are on their own over and over again. Great arm strength right there. That's just basketball. Steve Sanders at 6'3". Cameron Essex at about 5'10".
For Sanders, that's his second touchdown in his last three catches. So with that touchdown reception, he tied the record for the most points in a half in a bowl game.
And keep in mind, Bowling Green put 70 on Temple this year, so they're used to these kind of numbers.
Yeah, halfway home already at 35. Swisham gonna squib this one. And with a little bit of time still, Lakendis Cole They might be able to get a field goal still, a decent field goal range, a decent starting field position.
What's the arm strength of Omar Jacobs throwing off his back foot? The helmet goes flying out of there, and here just a jump ball. Cameron Essex actually jumped a little early. Steve Sanders timed his jump and went up.
That was Washington, LaVale Washington, that lost his hat.
Mark, you like that hair?
Yeah.
Omar Jacobs, you like that look?
It's kind of funky. I like it. Hey, you know what? Looks even better when he's throwing touchdowns.
Isn't that the truth?
Wimprime. And remember that Memphis has its full complement of three timeouts remaining. Gideon complete out to the 37-yard line, and they're going to use one of their timeouts here. The clock's still running with 15 seconds to go. Why wouldn't Tommy West use one of his timeouts to try and get into field goal range?
Mark, I think you bring up a great point, because obviously he's still throwing the football right here. He's not just trying to get the half, and wouldn't you love to have some extra seconds right now?
Yeah, Kelly instead will go down at the 41-yard line, and that's going to be the last play of the first half. A 22-yard pickup, and Kelly comes up a little bit lame for Memphis. He has been an integral part of their offensive attack here in the first half. That is not a favorable scene for the Tigers to end the first half on. Wimprown found his man, and let's go downstairs to Holly Rowe.
Hey, Coach, what was behind your thinking right there? You didn't call timeout to try to get in field goal range. What were you thinking?
To be honest, I thought he was out of bounds over here. And then when I looked up, we had to play. We thought we had one play, and we tried to go deep with it.
All right, Coach, you've been in a shootout like this before this year. What do you say to your team in the locker room to keep them focused with all these points going up?
Well, I mean, we got to get a stop. We got to get a stop or two defensively. We got to keep doing what we're doing offensively. We're in one of those. I hoped it wouldn't be this, but it is. So we got to get some stops.
You got 2-3 and outs. What has your defense done to get onto them a little bit?
Well, we got some sacks. We got to him. We got some sacks. We played decent against the run and try to knock one loose and get a turnover.
All right, thanks, Coach.
Okay.
Meanwhile, Kelly's still down on the field for Memphis. Did have a touchdown catch. Let's take one more look at how it happened. It's 35-28 at the break. And Chris Fowler, you know what? I got a gift for the DBs under their Christmas tree. How about an asbestos suit? Welcome back, everyone, to Ladd Peoples Stadium. The GMAC Bowl right now 35-28 at halftime. And we thought for a moment that Memphis actually scored during the break, but that wasn't the case. A lot of offensive bent in this game so far, led by Omar Jacobs, all part of the Aspen Edge game track. Had four touchdown passes in the first half alone. A spectacular one there to Steve Sanders. And meanwhile, countering for the Tigers, DeAngelo Williams, a touchdown burst there around the left end. And it's 35-28, and Holly Rowe downstairs with Greg Brandon.
Coach Brandon, you've been so efficient here in the first half. How do you keep your kids focused for the second half despite all the scoring?
Well, it's a new game, really. I mean, it's 7-0 the way I see it. And we have to keep protecting Omar, because if we can do that, he'll make throws and our kids will make plays.
How has your defense been able to catch up with them offensively?
Our defense has to make some stops. That's what it comes down to in this half. We have to possess the ball a little bit and keep their offense off the field.
All right, thanks very much, Coach. Mark?
All right, season's greetings. I'm Mark Jones along with Bob Davey, the sixth edition of this bowl game. Bob, towards the end of the first half, an interesting trend emerging as Memphis's defense kind of figured out that offense of Bowling Green a little bit.
A little bit, not much.
Yeah, just a little bit's a lot in this game.
You're right. And the bottom line, I don't think either defense can consistently stop the other offense. The key to me, no turnovers in the first half. Which defense creates a turnover in the second half? I think that team will win the football game. They can't stop them over an extended period of time. Get a sack, knock the ball out of the quarterback's hands, intercept the ball, cause a turnover in the kicking game. The defense that turns the ball over to their offense, Mark, I think will win this football game.
Jacobs ready to go to work here in the second half. Memphis kicking off, so Jacobs will get on the field first and the ball blow off the tee. For a minute there, thought it might be another onside kick attempt. We've already seen Bowling Green in the first half attempt an onside kick and recover it successfully.
And 624 yards total offense, 63 points in the first half. GMAC Bowl. That's all you have to say. Every year, it seems it's that way.
Well, if you're just joining us, Bob Davey predicted at the top of the show that this would be the highest scoring bowl game of the year, weather permitting. And the weather, well, we have to take this disclaimer off now, Bob, because the weather is pretty good right now. Ball out of bounds, and Jacobs will start the offense on his own 20-yard line. Take a look at the gaudy first half statistics. And we had a record tied for the most points in the first half of a bowl game, 63-0.
And as I mentioned, zero turnovers for either offense in the first half.
Jacobs, 260 passing yards. And he set a new MAC single season passing touchdown record with 40. First and 10 from the 20-yard line. This is Pope on the handoff, and Pope stopped up after a gain of about one by Albert Means. Albert Means, one of the guys we haven't talked much about, although he is one of the bright lights on that defensive front. Big fella, actually slimmed down a lot to get to where he is right now. A young man married with a wife and who he grew up with, married his childhood sweetheart.
And a highly publicized player. Number one defensive lineman in the country coming out of high school in Memphis, goes to Alabama, highly publicized part of that recruiting scandal, ends up transferring back to Memphis. Two-gap player in the NFL. Guy doesn't make a lot of plays, he's going to take up a bunch of space.
Jacob fires complete to Magner near the first down, just shy of the 30-yard line. Tim Goodwill making the stop on Cole Magner.
And the key to this football game, Dustin Lopez, Memphis's corner, back in the game, Mark. He was injured in the first half, obviously not being repetitive here, but so much pressure on these Memphis corners. They need all three corners to be healthy.
Third down and short. Lopez playing up on Hawkins this time.
And I'll tell you what, he is up on Hawkins down there.
That's as close as the DB's gotten.
Line up off sides.
They fumble the snap, but they're going to have the first down. Pope has it and more. Into Memphis territory at the 45-yard line, pushed out of bounds finally by Collins. So they only needed inches. Instead, they got 25 yards.
And a great block by one of the offensive linemen on number 8, Scott Vogel. The strong safety allowed P.J. Pope to break that outside. Keep your eye on Vogel right here, Mark. Right there, the left tackle pulling around, just engulfed him. Yeah. Corey Lichtenstein.
Wow. Did a nice job. Gives him first down and 10. The receiver screen incomplete, intended for Magner. It was a forward pass. The second down and 10, one of the few drops for Magner.
Mark, we haven't talked about this yet. Bowling Green won the bowling tournament. Every year they have a team versus team bowling tournament. Whoever wins that tournament, past history tells us they win the game. But the team from the north always going to win the bowling tournament, right?
Yeah, well, I guess so.
Because in the north, guys bowl a lot. In the south, Memphis guys aren't going to the bowling.
I guess you go inside during the winter months and do that kind of thing.
You got it.
You looked that up in the research department, the notes?
I grew up in the north.
Omar Jacobs going up top. Overshot his target at the 15-yard line. Sanders did get him behind to the secondary. Instead, it'll be third down and 10. Good pressure that time by Quentin McCrary.
You're exactly right. That was the reason that ball was incomplete. The outside linebacker, Quentin McCrary, coming right there, forced Omar Jacobs to throw a little bit premature. Big, big third down and 10 for the Memphis defense.
It was Jacobs that said prior to the game that, hey, I'm sure that Memphis has a good game plan, but frankly, I don't think they can stop us. And he's been true to form so far. Third and 10. Incomplete, and they stopped them on this series. It'll be fourth down, intended for Sharon, working on Dustin Lopez.
And you talk about great accuracy with Omar Jacobs. That's something the coaches talk about a little bit. lack of accuracy right here as we start this second half.
Yeah, Coach Nick Brendan looking a little bit perplexed on the sidelines. He talked to our Holly Rowe just a few moments ago and said, in his mind, it's just 7-0. Magner now back to punt once again. Traditionally, he likes to roll out to his left and punt it. Comes the other way. And it's fielded at the 13. White with a decent return. Just shy of the 30-yard line. And don't forget, coming up Friday at 7 o'clock Eastern Time, 4 Pacific. What is that, 2 o'clock in Hawaii? The Rainbow Warriors taking on the UAB Blazers. Timmy Chang, the all-time leading passer in NCAA history, leading the way for Hawaii.
And 5 Conference USA teams going to bowl games. How about Louisville, Cincinnati, South Florida, leaving Conference USA next year? Just made Memphis even a better coaching job for Tommy West.
Here's a look at DeAngelo. DeAngelo Williams turned it north-south and got across the 25 down to the 26-yard line. Got about 6 on the play. DeAngelo Williams led the nation with 21 rushing touchdowns. Averaged over 166 yards per game rushing.
Mark, back to that point. Louisville, Cincinnati, South Florida leaving Conference USA. Marshall, Central Florida will now be in the same division with Tommy West. But I think Southern Miss and Memphis now are obviously the teams to beat in next year's Conference USA.
Southern Miss doing a nice job in their bowl game a few nights ago, winning their bowl game convincingly out to the 34-yard line. DeAngelo Williams once again. Let's go downstairs to Holly.
Well, guys, just before the half, Chris Kelly was left on the field injured. He has a concussion, well, not a concussion, but he had his bell rung. They've checked him out, and they think he is okay to play here in the second half. If he has any headaches at all, they're going to pull him out. Also, Danny Wimprime, the quarterback for Memphis, took a hard hit on his shoulder. He does have a bruised shoulder, but he is going to continue to play. So Memphis a little bit banged up, but they are both going to play through that pain.
And there's Kelly, Holly, on the sidelines now. We just took a look at the injury that occurred right at the end of the first half. Here's the reverse run to Doss. He's brought down shy of the 40-yard line. We saw DeAngelo Williams limp off to the sidelines a few moments ago, and that might be of more concern to the Memphis Tigers. They're examining his right foot, his right leg. And no doubt that we'll have our Holly Rowe on that and get a medical report in just a few moments, but that's a huge sign of concern for the Tigers. Williams on the sideline with over 100 yards rushing, the 24th time that he's done that during his career.
And Williams with 295 carries coming into this game. Joseph Doss, the next leading carrier, with only 49. Again, that throwback screen.
Love that play. It's had some success in this ball game. Down to the 37. Doss once again. Let's take one more look at that run by Williams, the one in which he was injured. They were checking his right leg. Keep an eye on the right leg here.
Hard to see, Mark. Obviously, it looked like a high ankle injury, the way the trainers were, they were taking care of him on the sideline.
I remember a year ago that Williams wasn't able to play in his team's New Orleans bowl game because of a knee injury. Third down and 6. Wimprime fires, and it's incomplete at the 42-yard line. Broken up out of the arms of Maurice Avery. And it'll be fourth down for the Tigers.
How about back-to-back punts? But Memphis really looks at fourth down as another offensive play. Keep in mind, they faked 3 punts this year, converted all 3. But Danny Wimprime comes out, and their conventional punter is in the football game again. DeAngelo, with the helmet off, struggling a little bit on the sidelines.
Into punt, it's Brandon Roberson. Back deep, it's Charles Sharon at his own 26-yard line. Nice high spiral with the wind at his back. Sharon brought down immediately at the 18-yard line. Great coverage downfield by Jermaine Chambers on the 43-yard punt. That could light the fire under the Tigers. We'll find out when we come back. What's this? Welcome, everyone, back to Mobile, Alabama. A look at some of the Christmas sights and the holiday decorations all around town. This city really looking forward to this game tonight. We were staying at the Memphis team hotel, Bob. That lobby was real busy this afternoon and last night as well. Great time at the banquet yesterday afternoon. Boy, a red hat. Santa, is that Santa or no? Is that the real Santa? First down and 10, coming back the other way, Omar Jacobs. Stymied on his last drive and firing incomplete. So the trend totally different than it was in the first half. Meanwhile, Omar Jacobs, pardon me, that's DeAngelo Williams being tended to on the sidelines. I saw him limp off a few moments ago.
This Bowling Green offense, some amazing statistics. Only 8 turnovers all season, which is second in the nation. It's just amazing with the spread offense, as much as they throw it around, to only have 8 turnovers in a football season.
Second down and 10. We've played almost 5 minutes here in the third quarter. Nobody scored. Imagine that. Jacobs to Magner. And hit and stopped immediately at the 25 by Vogel. Let's go downstairs for an update on Williams from Holly.
Well, guys, good news for DeAngelo Williams. He does have a right leg injury. They have just retaped him and let him run along the sidelines. He does appear to be okay. The trainer has said that he is clear to go back into the game. Guys, we'll see how long he can go with that right leg injury. It looks right around the shin and calf area, the mid leg on his right leg.
But we'll see if he does come back in on that next series, Holly. Third down and 3. Little heat coming from Jolie Dunn's defense, but the pass complete. And they got the first down at the 30-yard line to Steve Sanders. Much to the dismay of Jolie Dunn, the defensive coordinator for Memphis.
And that time, Jolie brings 6 blitzers, but they have 6 blockers because the back's in the backfield, and you just run away from the safety who has man coverage. Really difficult. 6 blitzers, 6 blockers are going to pick them up. The safety has virtually no chance right there. So if you're going to blitz them, you have to bring one more than they have the ability to block.
As a result, the 7th catch of the night for Steve Sanders.
Again, you see the cushion now with these corners playing off.
Little option package here. Jacobs can keep it himself, and he got rocked. Wesley Smith came up from the secondary on support that time and put a lick on Omar Jacobs. Not sure exactly who won that, though. Jacobs
and Wesley Smith is a great tackler, Conference USA first team all free safety. That's a lick right there. He's made first team Conference USA defensive team 2 years in a row.
So a second down and 4. He trips right formation now for Omar Jacobs in the offense. Magner on that little receiver screen. Magner lost his footing at the 40-yard line and is stopped by Collins. But it's close to another first down, just beyond the 40-yard line.
And really, that's just a running play in their offense. Steve Sanders at 6'3", 205 pounds out there, who made the great catch. You're going to see him right here come off and block. Excellent job right there. I'm not holding. Cole Magner just fighting for extra yards. That's really just a running play.
Magner with his 7th catch of the game. And they did get the first down at the 41.
You see the tight bunch formation right there. 3 receivers. Again, Cole Magner in motion.
Jacobs looked his way initially. Thought about throwing it away. Then Magner almost came up with a nice catch. But it's incomplete. Second down and 10 to go. Both these teams come into this ball game with a record of 8-3. Bowling Green talked about finishing off this season on a positive note after they lost their last game, Bob, against Toledo.
Yeah, Mark, they were up 27-7 at the half in a game in Toledo. They lost the game. Then they had to sit and wait to see if they were going to have an opportunity to be in the bowl game. So they appreciate this opportunity to be here in the GMAC Bowl because they didn't think they were going after the loss to Toledo.
Second Back-to-back bull. Oh, that one picked off. Vogel read it. It was intended for McGrady, and Vogel had a beat on it. That's just the fourth interception of the season thrown by Omar Jacobs. And it gives Memphis fabulous field position.
We talked about at halftime, the team that created a turnover would win this football game. And right here, Omar Jacobs rolling to his left. Vogel again, Mark, a great story. Three ACL surgeries. Good to see him make a play.
And good to see DeAngelo Williams back in the ball game for Memphis. On first down and 10, that was Vogel's third pick of the season, the 11th. We're at the 36. That's Tavares Gideon. I'm Mark Jones along with Bob Davey, Holly Rose down in the field. This is the sixth edition of the GMAC Bowl, and what an offensive showcase it's been, keeping in custom. Bowling Green leading 35-28. And a couple of series ago, we saw DeAngelo Williams shaken up, but now he's back in the ballgame. See how effective he can be carrying the football. Here he is. Williams down at the 34-yard line. Didn't really see him out in space that time, Bob. He was tackled by Keon Newsom. DeAngelo Williams led the NCAA in scoring this year. Interesting young man out of Wynn, Arkansas. Initially didn't sign with Memphis until 2 weeks after the national signing day. Third down and 3.
And again, three backs in the backfield for Memphis. A lot of different formations.
Move it to Williams. And he stopped up short of the first down at about the 32. And at this time, folks, I'd like to apologize for some of our technical difficulties. We had a torrential downpour here earlier in the night, and that has wreaked havoc with some of our circuitry and this, our wiring.
And this is a no-brainer right here on fourth down. You have to go for it. And they say they stay in the spread offense. Do not put the fullback Robert Douglas in the game. I would have to say DeAngelo Williams going to carry this football, Mark.
And Whitbrine going to call a timeout. But, Bob, you know, in the last couple of carries, just an observation by me, it doesn't seem like Williams has that burst that he had before that injury.
You see him limping a little bit there, Mark.
Timeout on the field. We'll be back with more right after this.
ESPN's presentation of the 2004 GMAC Bowl. Brought to you by Capital One. What's in your wallet? And Bodman Fragrance Sprays by Body Fantasies.
Oh, DeAngelo Williams got that kind of build. Same kind of abs as that guy on the head. Pretty city of Mobile, Alabama, one of the jewels of the South, aglow at night. Fourth down and short for Memphis.
And Robert Douglas, the fullback in the game at 235 pounds, was a linebacker. Look for him to be the lead blocker right here.
They had too many men on the field. They're trying to get somebody off the field. And that's going to be a penalty. Well, they broke the huddle with the formation, then ran somebody off. How do you have that happen coming out of a timeout, Bob?
Prior to the snap, illegal substitution, the offense. 5-yard penalty for the previous spot, still fourth down.
Changes the complexions of things quite a bit now for Tommy West.
You're right, that shouldn't happen coming out of a timeout. One thing you know if you've coached, things do happen that you never expect. Particularly when you're a multiple substitution, multiple formation team like Memphis. Now the decision, you don't want to squander away another timeout here if you're Memphis. You better hurry up. The clock down to 15 seconds right here.
Remember at the end of the first half, they did not want to call the timeout that might have gotten them into field goal.
And they're confused right here. They're going to get another penalty.
Oh, my goodness. Look at this, an instant replay.
Prior to the snap, legal substitution, again on offense. 5-yard penalty, previous spot, so fourth down.
This is what you call self-destruction.
What do you do now? Twice. Tommy West is incredulous there on the sidelines.
I punt the football right now.
Let's go downstairs for more on Holly from Holly Rowe.
Guys, one of the problems, the rule in the NCAA right now is if you break the huddle with too many guys, that's a penalty. But because they don't huddle, it's when they come from the sideline. That time we saw them set up on offense, come from the sideline, but then DeAngelo Williams trotted out of the games. So it's just a little technicality because they're no huddle team right now. It's making it confusing for Memphis.
Well, the rule is you have to give the defense the opportunity to see your personnel in the game so they have a chance to substitute, and they will punt this football right here with Danny Wimbrand.
Well, that's two costly plays and penalties for the Tigers. Wimbrand going to get a nice squib kick, rugby-style kickoff that'll be marked out of bounds at about the 11-yard line, but they go from fourth and inches to having to punt because of some substitution and personnel issues.
And think back, they did not take opportunity that the turnover, the interception, gave them right there, Memphis offense.
Welcome back, everyone, to Ladd People Stadium in Mobile, Alabama. The original home of Mardi Gras in the United States. It's the GMAC Bowl, edition number 6, and an interesting one it is. After a scoring outburst of 63 points in the first half, neither team has scored here in the second half. First and 10 in the worst starting field position of the game for Bowling Green. Pope at about 5. Up beyond the 15 to the 17-yard line, and it's been a stark contrast of first and second half for Omar Jacobs, just 4 of 10 with a pick.
Keep in mind, again, he is going into the wind here as we start the second half, but not nearly as accurate as he has been, and that's why P.J. Pope right now, that tailback mark is a key guy because they have to take the pressure off the quarterback right now. He's struggling.
And Pope was met in field. Boy, Tim Goodwell, for the third time tonight, had a good beat on that running play.
Tim Goodwell, their number one tackler. They have three really athletic linebackers.
Loss on the play back to the 16-yard line. And there's a look at the impressive stats by Goodwill. 6.5 tackles for loss on the year. Third and long.
Right now, Omar Jacobs has to bounce back from that interception on the last series. Time for him to step up and make a play because it's going to be man-to-man coverage.
Jacobs completes it and then some. First down at the 45, Charles Sherritt. A pickup of 29 yards, and that should do a little bit for the confidence of Jacobs. Not that it was shaken, but at least he's got it back.
And right there, I mean, just a quick three-step drop. Great throw on the slant route and huge for the confidence of the quarterback.
There's Magner. Magner out near another first down at the 44-yard line of the Tigers. Good block out front by Steve Sanders. Bob, the one thing in this formation that you notice is that those receivers have to do a lot of blocking downfield for Bowling Green.
And what you do now that you know the offense you're in, Bowling Green's been in this for 4 years, you recruit to it. And you see Steve Saunders, one of the roles of those inside receivers, you have to be able to block on those pass screen slash run plays. Really kind of like the fullback in this offense sometimes, because that's not much more than a toss sweep in the old style football.
First and 10. Jacobs slings it out of bounds. Nobody open on that play. Just under 4.5 minutes to go.
You wonder sometimes with the ball in the middle of the field. Actually, the ball was on the hash, so it does make sense to roll Omar Jacobs to his left. But you see him a lot of times, the right-hand quarterback rolling to his left, which is a difficult throw.
Second down and 10 to go for Bowling Green.
Here they come, six blockers on six rushers.
And Jacobs has time and can show that he can run. Jacobs tackled short of the 30-yard line. And he got the first down, picking up 14. Nice little burst there to get the first.
Again, you're going to see six blitzers coming on six blockers and man-free coverage this time. And the quarterback, once he breaks the line of scrimmage, there's a huge gap in the middle of this football field. And Omar Jacobs will run over the corner right here late.
And Magner with another good pickup for Bowling Green down to the 17-yard line. Magner had his hat come off inadvertently.
Go back to that third down slant route by Omar Jacobs on the slant to Charles Sharon. Big third down conversion. This offense is back in sync.
Really done now, and his defense going to have to make another adjustment. Stop the flow here of the offense. They give it to Pope, and Pope is stopped up just shy of the 13-yard line. As we approach 4 minutes to go in the third quarter. Marcus West making the stop for the Tiger defense. You look at the breakdown of the scoring in the ballgame. All of it in the first half. 28 points in the first quarter, 35 points in the second quarter, and zero in the third so far. With Bowling Green threatening here in the red zone.
Empty formation. Look for an all-out blitz. They're going to bring these six rushers on these five blockers, and it's straight man-to-man coverage, Mark.
Sanders, one of their dangerous receivers in the red zone here. With his size, they go to Sanders, and he couldn't hang on to it. He had beaten O.C. Collins on the play, and it's third down and seven.
It's all about X and O's. That time you're going to get a straight man blitz. They're going to blitz these six guys as blitzers on five rushers, but Bowling Green brings the running back in to be the sixth blocker on the sixth rusher, but they had a miscue in assignment right there. They had the right numbers, Mark.
Third down and seven.
Again, here they come again.
Heavy touchdown. Heat. Oh, what a call. Touchdown. They caught them in the blitz, and Pope waltzed into the end zone. Jolie Dunn experiencing headache number 47.
Great coaching by Bowling Green. If you want to keep blitzing, you better cover the back on that screen. That was all on play calling right there. Greg Studrawa, offensive line coach, offensive coordinator, great answer to the blitz.
Zwiski's extra point is good, and Pope, a very versatile back. We've talked about the multiplicity of his skills. That's his sixth touchdown catch this season, the seventh of his career. Nobody in the same 251 area code as him on that play. We'll be back with more from Mobile after this. Welcome back, everyone, to the GMAC Bowl as Jacobs throws the touchdown pass on the wonderful call.
That's a big old offensive coordinator right there.
You first look at him, you think he's the strength coach.
Played offensive line at Bowling Green. He's fun to watch, coach. We went out and watched him practice the other day. He's a lot of fun.
And that fifth touchdown pass by Jacobs, tying a career high. Tigers finally get a chance to return it. This is Chris Kelly, who was shaken up a little bit earlier. And let's go back and look at that fifth touchdown pass of the game by Omar Jacobs.
We talked about when you blitz, get an extra blitzer on how many rushers. They have six blockers up here, five offensive linemen and running back. Memphis is going to bring seven guys. The four DBs are going to play coverage, but you have to cover the running back. So they bring seven on six. Somebody has to spy P.J. Pope. Nobody covers them. That is great coaching by Bowling Green right there. The answer to the blitz.
Well, Danny Wimprine got to get going here. First down and 10. But they too can score points in bunches. That one almost intercepted. Carswell broke it up. I think one more look at Strujawa.
Greg Studrawa. They can't hear you. You can pound that table all you want. That's not your prototypical offensive coordinator, is it? That's an offensive line coach who became an offensive coordinator. in this Memphis offense, this game's not over. They can score quick. They got to go ahead and make some plays right here.
There's Williams. Broke a tackle. Williams seemed to get a little bit of his giddy up back on that run out to the 37-yard line. Close to the first down, DeAngelo Williams. Broke through the tackle of Jelani Jordan.
And you know DeAngelo Williams, a junior, will take some time to figure out whether to come out in the NFL draft or not. And one thing I think you keep in mind, running backs don't necessarily go in the first round now like they used to. And I think Bill Parcells last year at Dallas taking Julius Jones in the second round, and Julius Jones turning into an outstanding back. You see less and less first-round running backs.
Williams.
He blew a tire right there.
It looked like nobody was near him that time. This one might be a little bit more serious.
Holly talked about it was a calf injury.
Yeah, he went down. I don't even think he was tackled that time, Bob. He was going to come off.
You're exactly right. I mean, that left calf, and that's a lot of calf right there because he is packed on the lower body. It almost looked like a cramp. But right there, Mark, you're right. He was not touched. I think he cramped up.
They're working on him on the sidelines. Meanwhile, Joseph Doss, his understudy, into the ball game as the rain continues now to sprinkle down. It's coming. Flags down on the play. Gideon up to the 43, but there's two flags down on the play. Williams being tended to on the sidelines. Tell you a little bit about Williams again and his meticulous nature. As we get the call, it's going to go against the offense, but Williams during the offseason asked the video coaches a special request. They asked that he make up a tape of every one of his runs during the past season. That's 243 runs, all on one tape. He took it home, he studied it, and he studied his tendencies, his moves, his linemen, the defense's reactions. That's very thorough.
He probably took it home so his mom could study it. Tell me, his mom is a great football fan. Here at the game, Holly Rowe spent some time with DeAngelo's mom last night. So she's right in the middle of it. Calls him every day after practice to see how practice went. And that's one of the reasons he went to Memphis. It's only 40 miles from his hometown of Wynn, Arkansas.
Andrew Hill watching the game. Third down and 5. Try and hang on to this drive and keep it alive. Incomplete at midfield, but a flag down. Chris Kelly couldn't hang on, but we may have some pass interference on Crumpler as a result. That would make it 1st and 10.
We get to take a look at this right here. Yeah, the left hand. You see so many times when you try to make a play.
Pass interference. Defense. Number 31.
That is a huge, huge call in this football game for Memphis. And the left hand by Crumpler was holding as we see that rain start to come down.
That was the first penalty of the game against Bowling Green.
This has been a well-played football game.
1st and 10 on Bowling Green side of midfield for the Tigers.
And with DeAngelo Williams out, you see 5 wide receivers in the football game. In the bubble to Joseph Doss.
And he is met immediately back at the 46-yard line. They do miss Williams and his meticulous nature. Told you about the tape he had made during the offseason. Holly Rowe talked with him about it before the game.
Everybody said my first step is like the fastest they've ever seen, and I think that it can get so much faster. I'm always, if you say I'm fast, I think I can get faster because I'm a workaholic. I don't try to outwork all the running backs. I try to outwork everybody on the team.
We can only hope that he'll get back into the ball game and show that tremendous work ethic of his. He's already gone for over 120 yards. Jim Prime. Boy, he threaded the needle that time. A picture of precision down to the 42. Tavares Gideon, the former junior college transfer, set a school record this year. Gideon did with 19 touchdown receptions.
He's their deep threat. And I'll tell you what, you said it. Danny Wimprine fired this one in there against zone coverage. Tavares Gideon missed all the last year with a knee injury. But he is their deep threat.
gives them a workable third down and five after that 10-yard pickup. Under a minute to go now in the third quarter of play.
You have to wonder right here, does he set it up for two downs on fourth and five?
And he lost the ball. It's live. It's a fumble. And Bowling Green got it at the 26-yard line of Memphis. An egregious error that time by Wimprine. Taylor recovering the loose ball.
At halftime, we talked about defenses creating turnovers. The defense didn't actually create this one. Danny Wimprine, the ball slips out of his hands. And Bowling Green's defense comes up with a huge stop on third down and five.
Each team now, Bob, with one turnover. That one very costly for Memphis. And important that Memphis has not scored in this period yet with the win at their backs. Bowling Green first and 10. Pope between the tackles met at the 20-yard line. Got about five. Pope scored the touchdown last time for Bowling Green on that nice screen pass.
And you go back to that third and five with Memphis, ball in midfield, maybe four down territory, down 14 points. But without DeAngelo Williams in the game, I don't think they were going to run the football. They try to throw it and they turn it over. And Bowling Green in commanding shape right now.
That's the end of the third quarter of play. Wimprine with 60 family members here in attendance watching him. The bowl road trip continues here in Mobile, Alabama. And what a journey it's been. We've had offensive fireworks, but the defenses have squelched the fire here just a little bit here in the second half. Will Williams come back in the fourth quarter? Will it be his last game? He won't want to go out like this. A great fourth quarter coming up. Welcome back, everyone, for the start of the fourth quarter. I'm Mark Jones, along with Bob Davey, Holly Rowe, down on the field in the GMAC Bowl. And if you have a quarterback to pull the trigger, it'll make you successful in this ball game. There has been a long, prolific lineage of great quarterbacks in this ball game, and two on display tonight. Right now, Omar Jacobs on the field for Bowling Green. He's looking at second down and five.
Empty formation, blitz coming again. Chance for a big play.
Conference USA and MAC, and look at the quarterbacks out of those respective conferences that have done well in this ball game. Leftwich, his team in the MAC and the GMAC Bowl, 2001, 2002, now doing well with Jacksonville in the NFL. Roethlisberger, if you've been on a different planet, maybe you don't know, but he's having an outstanding year with Pittsburgh.
In the MAC conference, these spread offenses and marquee name players have put the MAC conference on the map all over the country.
Second and 10, they hand it off to Pope over the left side, brought down at the 20-yard line. Bob, back to that list of quarterbacks. And you talked about the MAC conference, the offensive systems they run. Does that make it more conducive to making a smooth transition to the NFL, which Leftwich and Roethlisberger have done subsequently?
I think the first step, it gives you great opportunities to impress the NFL scouts, because if you can throw it and pile up statistics, you're going to get evaluated by the NFL. And I do think, to a degree, obviously, if you throw the football a lot in college, it's going to help you in the transition in the NFL. The only thing, there's a bunch of shotgun spread teams, and there's not that many, if any, of those in the NFL.
This one batted down at the line of scrimmage by David McNair. And Bob, this might be one of the soft spots in Omar's game.
Excellent point. You see how low he throws the football right here? That comes from right behind his ear. Very athletic play by David McNair. But they actually tried to get him early in his career to raise the ball up a little bit, because he did drop his elbow and throw the ball into the back of some offensive linemen.
And in comes Sean Sweeson for a field goal attempt. Has a long of 52 on the season. This year, 13 of 19.
And a stiff wind at his back to his advantage.
From 37 yards out, he's 5 of 8 from this distance, and he nails this one right down the middle. increases the lead to 45-28. A 17-point advantage, but you can't sleep on the Tigers. When we come back, we'll have an update on the condition and the health of DeAngelo Williams, their star tailback. Tell you, Bob Davey, that is the look, the beard of choice in Southwest Ohio right now.
Well,
it's a natural, isn't it? Or is that a dye job?
That guy's from Northwest Ohio. It's about as good as it gets. Comes down here, got him some Mardi Gras beads.
This is like the tropics for them, right? Exactly. I mean, they got all that snow up in Ohio.
Good
recently.
As it gets. They're getting pounded up there tonight.
A balmy 61 degrees at kickoff here in Mobile, Alabama. The rain has stopped temporarily. Clark watches it bounce through the back of the end zone. The Tigers need something very good to happen here right now on this drive, and it would be very good if DeAngelo Williams were able to come out onto the field. He was shaken up. He has a calf strain. Mark Jones along with Bob Davey and Holly Rowe as we are just underway here in the fourth quarter of play. Danny Wimprine, the senior quarterback who holds virtually every passing record in Memphis school history, with a daunting challenge ahead of him. His team down right now in the fourth quarter.
We see Joseph Doss in the game, so DeAngelo Williams not in the game, and they have to do this against the wind.
Doss out of the backfield, couldn't hang on to it. Let's go downstairs to Holly for more.
Well, guys, if the Tigers are going to mount a comeback right now, they're going to have to do it without DeAngelo Williams. He's been taken to the locker room for x-rays. He told the trainer, Ed Cantler, that he felt something pop in that right leg. They are worried that it may be a possible fracture of his fibula. They're not saying right now. They're going to wait and see what the x-rays say. But, guys, a big loss right now, not only in the running game, but as you can see right there with Mike Doss dropping that pass, also as a reliable receiver.
Yeah, good point, Holly. Williams last year missed his bowl game in New Orleans because of a knee injury. And with that injury, the catch made by White, with that injury to Williams, more complex items to be considered because of his status. He's a junior, but there has been talk about him entering the NFL draft. 13:43 to go in the fourth quarter.
DeAngelo Williams out, even on third and one, empty formation with no back in the backfield. It's all on Danny Wimprine now to carry this Memphis team.
He's going to run it himself, but I don't think he got the first down. Stopped up at about the 37 by Pipko.
And I love Memphis's plan, but I don't like that call. A quarterback draw on third down and one. And Memphis will go for it right here. Excuse me, Wimprine will probably drop back and punt this football, but wow, they have self-destructed offensively here in the second half. That was an interesting call, quarterback draw on third down and one.
Go back to what happened to them out of the two timeouts. Here's the rugby-style kick. To Bowling Green territory, out of bounds at the 45. To go back to what happened coming out of those two timeouts, the illegal substitutions, the two subsequent penalties, all of a sudden they're back on their own side of midfield, and it all went downhill from there.
And then the next series, the turnover by Danny Wimprine on third down and five.
Jacobs and Bowling Green looking good when we come back. Green leading 45-28 with 12:41 to go in the fourth quarter, and the beat continues for the offense and Omar Jacobs. For 10 points here in the second half. The most concern for Memphis is the health of DeAngelo Williams. And for an update, here's Holly.
Well, guys, the trainer for Memphis, Ed Cantler, has just told me that the x-rays are back and DeAngelo Williams has a fractured fibula. He said it is a non-displaced fracture, meaning the bones are lined up very nicely. He says he'll be fine. He'll heal nicely from this. But, guys, this not only adds to the question of not coming back in this game, but now what does he do with his pro? He may have already made a decision prior to this game, but now it may change because of this injury, guys. Something to consider.
Yeah, that certainly complicates the formula a little bit.
And you're certainly glad that it's not a joint injury, particularly the knee. And I think one thing at a time for DeAngelo Williams, the first thing is to get back healthy.
Well, when you think about some of the running backs that are projected to go high. Here's a look at the Benson of Texas, and you go down to the junior class. And remember, Williams is still a junior. It's he, Faison, Morenci from Oklahoma State.
And Faison has already declared that he's going to come out in the NFL draft. One thing DeAngelo Williams can do, he can catch the football. The second thing is he can block.
Bob, I think about Willis McGahee, what happened to him a couple of years ago. Although his story had a happy ending, here's Jacobs passing complete down to the 34-yard line in a first down for Bowling Green to Charles Sharon. You think about what happened to McGahee in that championship game. Injured, blew his knee up. And ultimately, he was still chosen in the first round of the draft by the Buffalo Bills. It put him in a very tenuous position coming back to play that extra year. There's Tommy West, and Williams have spoken about his future. And West says that Williams has asked all the right questions. He's a very sharp young man. First and 10. And then off the Pope. Pope looking very fresh right now, albeit late in the game. Crossed the 25, down to the 24. Got a nice block up front by Murkowski. Murkowski, Lichtensteiger, Warren doing a nice job up front for that offensive line. Guys, we don't talk about it.
Well, in this spread offense, the offensive linemen, they don't get much publicity in any kind of offense, but it seems like even less in the spread offense. And you have to be impressed with this Bowling Green program. You know, next year they open up at Wisconsin and at Boise State, but Omar Jacobs is back.
That's the good news. Pope again. Inside handoff down to the 21-yard line. We approach 10 minutes to go.
And talking about Bowling Green, they've made a commitment. Yesterday at the luncheon, a gentleman was there that gave around $4 million himself for a new building, new football building in the end zone, new coaches' offices, new weight room. And they've also made a commitment to pay assistant coaches more, which is a huge factor at schools in the MAC and the Conference USA, because what happens, assistant coaches have success and they move on to other conferences that can pay more. So they've stepped it up for the assistant coaches.
First and 10, and here's Pope again running to the field. Down inside the 15 to the 14, and you talk about improving conditions for assistant coaches. There's one of them up in the booth, and Bob, it really highlights the fact that with that $4 million donation at Bowling Green, that it kind of keeps Greg Brandon back in the fold. He and his entire staff. For Brandon, it's been well noted, he did interview for the UNLV head coaching football job. And he is back now on the sidelines at Bowling Green. This conference has been a nice cradle for coaches.
Exactly.
Just a few years ago, Urban Meyer was right here on the sidelines of Bowling Green. Now the head coach at Florida. Second and 3, and Pope inside the 10 down to the 8-yard line. And you get the feeling this offense just having its way even more so now with that defense of Memphis running the ball.
And I think Memphis came out defensively in the second half. We look at Joe Lee Dunn. They played better. Omar Jacobs was struggling a little bit with consistency. Memphis offensively self-destructed, could not take advantage of the turnover that Memphis created, the interception. And then Memphis offense turned the football over. So their defense has played a little bit better, but it's like now the reality is set in and the air's come out of the balloon. And Memphis looks so lackadaisical right now, getting lined up on defense, that there's not much fight left.
Pope has carried the ball 6 times on this drive. They bring the pressure. Here's his 7th carry. And he got down to the 1-yard line. It's a fumble. Bowling Green got it back. Magner, they signal touchdown. They may not mark it, though, as a touchdown. They're going to bring it out to the 1 because it was fumbled forward.
It was ruled down at the 1-yard line. Watch
and down. You're going to say that he was down already at the 1.
And again, Memphis, not much left in that tank on defense. P.J. Pope here just dragging guys in. Excellent call. That right knee was down prior to that football coming out. But Cole Magner recovering that football shows me that Memphis is about out of gas right now, Mark.
Bowling Green, 8-0 when Pope goes for over 100. The The gauge is at 151, and he tacks on a few more for the score. Pope writing the obituary for the Tigers right now.
And last year, Miami of Ohio came into this game, put a whipping on Louisville. This year, Bowling Green from the MAC comes in here and right now is putting a whipping on Memphis.
Mid-American Conference having its way with Conference USA once again.
And they are 5-0 versus Conference USA teams in bowl games, and the MAC has won 8 of their last 9 bowl games, period, since 1998.
Charles Sharon shaking what his mama gave him on the sidelines, and he's done it on the field along with P.J. Pope. 52-28 when we come back to Mobile. All right, Chris, and yeah, Nick Saban apparently going to be given some pretty good latitude with respect to personnel decisions with the Dolphins. And, of course, everybody knows that Wayne Huizenga, the owner down there in South Florida, willing to do mostly anything to get that thing back on track.
And you have to think Dave wants that if it works out, that's a great hire at the University of Pittsburgh. And keep in mind, Pittsburgh next year opens up with Notre Dame at Heinz Field. Charlie Weiss coming over from the New England Patriots. Dave Wanstead, maybe the head coach at Pittsburgh next year. Notre Dame-Pittsburgh, first game of the year.
Lots of compelling, interesting storylines coming into that game. First down and 10, Wimprine. Screen pass complete. Gain of about 5 out to the 25-yard line. Wimprine, the all-time leading passer in Memphis Tigers School of History. Turning point in his career actually came last year in a game against Tulane. Interesting story. He was playing in front of friends and family members back home in New Orleans, and people in the huddle, people on the sideline said that he resisted the temptation of trying to do too much in front of those family members and really showed strong leadership, not getting much help on that play from Doss. But he has gone on to really have a productive career in the last couple seasons for Memphis. Don't forget, tomorrow night, 2 more bowl games on ESPN. Plains Capital Fort Worth Bowl. That's Marshall against Cincinnati. That's Cincinnati's out of the MAC. MAC and Conference USA matchup once again. And Pioneer Pure Vision Las Vegas Bowl, Wyoming against UCLA. And did I mention, Bob, that in the Sonic Bowl Challenge that yours truly was actually out in front so far after the first 2 bowl games? I didn't mention that, did I?
Early in the first quarter, but don't start patting yourself on the back. There's a bunch of ball left to be played in this bowl season.
Third down and 5, almost picked off, but a nice catch instead by Gideon. Tavares Gideon tiptoes up the sidelines. 7:15 to go in the fourth quarter. Boy, what a great bowl game and season it's going to be. Talked about Bowling Green opening up next year at Wisconsin. We're going to get a good look at the Badgers in the Outback Bowl on New Year's Day against Georgia.
I'll bet you Barry Alvarez is watching this football game.
Saving that tape, huh?
Maybe down at his condo in Naples right now, worrying a little bit about Bowling Green next year, even though they have Georgia this year.
Here's Doss, yeah, out to the 43. You think he can worry about them already?
Oh,
this early?
That's the nature. That's why you pay all that money. I mean, you always think of the next one.
There's 7 minutes to go, and there's a look at Jacobs. That will be one of the objects of the game planning defensively for Brett Bielema, defensive coordinator for Wisconsin next year when they open up. Second down and 3. Pass complete to Kelly down to the 45. Nice to see him back in the ball game doing his thing. Carswell made the stop. If you're just joining us, DeAngelo Williams, we learned just a few moments ago from Holly Rowe down on the sidelines, has suffered a broken fibula. But he is expecting to make a normal recovery. But he was the 3rd leading rusher in the nation. The pass complete down to the 22-yard line to White. 6:26 to go in the fourth quarter. A 23-yard pickup, and now White comes up limping. What a rough day on those Memphis players.
Darren White, 2nd in all-time catches at Memphis, coming into this game with 135. He's had a great 4-year career.
First and 10 from the 22. Handed off to Doss. No room up the middle of that defense. Fowler and Williams and Parks, Crossley holding stout and steady up front defensively for Bowling Green with 6:03 to go. Memphis came in at 8-3. Bowling Green came into this game also at 8-3. Imprime incomplete at the 8, intended once again for Kelly.
And the bottom line in this football game, because Memphis's defense really could not stop Bowling Green, Memphis's offense had to take advantage of every opportunity to score. And when Memphis offense self-destructed in the second half, it opened the floodgates for Bowling Green.
Never really recovered since on third down and 10 now.
You notice Bowling Green had a lot more two safety look back there.
That's complete. Wimprine able to find one of the openings in the defense, complete to Maurice Avery. It's all about the self-destruction. This was the first penalty. And this was coming out of a timeout.
And it was 4th and 1. And it ended up being 4th and 16 after the 2 illegal substitution penalties. Then on the next series, on a 3rd and 5 at Bowling Green's 41, Danny Wimprine turns the football over.
And Tommy
at that
West,
point, Mark, yeah, they were only down 7 right. points in this football game.
Offense, number 53. 5-yard penalty from the previous spot. Still 4th down.
Wimprine and Tommy West are going to look back at those 3 plays, those 2 sequences, as the turning point, the pivotal point of this ball game.
And the truth, you got the feeling coming into this game, a little bit like Louisville, Miami last year. I'm not sure Conference USA totally respects the MAC conference as much as we do, because we see them right. so much.
A little bit of an unknown still, but year after year, as Mid-American Conference teams continue to have success in these bowl games, people are finding out no longer under the radar. Gideon makes the catch down to the 12. Under 5 minutes to go now. And Brian will end his career, perhaps get a look from the National Football League. Owns 7 career passing marks at Memphis. Been the starting quarterback here since midway through the 2001 season, a native of New Orleans. Putting himself fairly well today. And Brian into the end zone. Incomplete. Gideon, his favorite target in the red zone. And why not at 6'4", 210? He'll go up there and win most of those jump balls. And they like to throw those fades to him in these situations. And Jordan, meanwhile, the corner, just 5'10", so they got a bit of a mismatch on the perimeter.
But the difference, you notice Bowling Green with safety help over the top, right here with the safety back to help the corner, different than what Memphis does on defense with one safety in the middle.
Doss on the pitch on the option, slipped. And it was brought down at the 15. It's going to be 3rd down and long. Burks. And Burks came into the game saying, you know what, I'm tired about hearing about all these high-powered offenses, scoring, touchdowns, passing, completions. Hey, we're going to put a stamp on this thing before it's over.
He did. I mean, he took it personal. He flat said there's been a lot of talk about these offenses, but we're going to play some defense. This kid's played with 2 broken bones in his hands all year.
11th play of the drive for Wimprine. Underneath, wide open, Doucette. Touchdown.
And Doucette came into this game with only 10 catches. He leaves here tonight with 2 touchdowns.
Filling his hat. Big fella can move it a little bit.
It's a great effort for 2. By the big man.
They're going to actually kick the extra point. They knock it through. Down that many points, down 18, wouldn't the formula or that sheet that they all talk about to say that they go for 2? Regardless, they go for the extra point. And Doucette with the touchdown. 87 points on the board. We'll be back with more after this.
ESPN's presentation of the 2004 GMAC Bowl. Brought to you by GMAC, the financial services people from General Motors.
Orange is the color of the day as Bowling Green leads 52-35 with 3:48 to go in the fourth quarter. But, Bob, why wouldn't Memphis go for the two-point conversion? Then you make it perhaps a 16-point game. So that's actually a workable margin if you can at two touchdowns and two extra points. And Bowling Green recovers the onside kick attempt.
Well, you just answered it. You're right. They should have gone for two, try to turn it into a 16-point game.
DeAngelo Williams, meanwhile, on the sidelines for Memphis. He was injured. Our Holly Rowe reporting just a few moments ago that he suffered a broken fibula. Third leading rusher in the nation, taken out of the game in the second half. Well, that's a heck of a Christmas wish. Right now, Bob, I would bet against it. What do you think?
Well, I don't know enough to bet, Mark. I mean, I think you have to be around those players, know those players, what motivates him. I think it's impossible for me to make a guess right now.
First down and 10. That's B.J. Lane in the ball game, getting the carry down to the 30-yard line of Memphis. 3:38 to go in the night.
And B.J. Lane has played a lot of football over the last 2 years for Bowling Green. And the MAC comes down to Mobile again. Guy gets a little FaceTime right there. He'll be heading back to that snow tomorrow. He better enjoy all he can down here tonight.
You wish the best in terms of recovery for DeAngelo Williams. Had a chance to watch him and some of his teammates interact earlier today in the team hotel, which we happen to be staying at as well. Bob, they're playing the piano and doing pretty well at it. DeAngelo singing a couple of tunes along the way in tonight's game track presented by Aspen Edge. I'll tell you, who's been carrying a nice note tonight is Omar Jacobs, the quarterback, with five touchdown passes. That one going to P.J. Pope. And here was the injury that effectively ended the night for DeAngelo Williams, breaking his fibula. And Memphis self-destructing big time here in the second half of play. Fumbled by Winfrein after those two illegal substitutions. Second and one, Jacobs hands it off to Lane. Lane has a first down.
And I know this football game's over, but if I'm Memphis right now, I am really concerned about this defensive football team. And I think they will reevaluate what they do defensively and how they do it. But what would really concern me, there is no fight left in this football team. And they're about to let Bowling Green take this ball down the field and score again.
They've got 28 seniors on that Memphis squad playing their last game. So plenty of holes to fill for next year. And head coach Tommy West, who recently had his contract extended through the year 2009. And through some very benevolent local donations from the business community, had his salary up to some $800,000 per annum. And tonight's Capital One player of the game, Omar Jacobs, out of Delray Beach, Florida, from the 561 down in the bottom, as we affectionately call it, Bob. And his TD to pick ratio now has plummeted to 10.25 to 1. Oh, he's in trouble.
It's amazing that a guy that was offered by Buffalo, Florida Atlantic, and Florida A&M, recruited by Kansas State a little bit. In fact, Urban Meyer got the call from one of Kansas State's assistants when they got off him. That's how Bowling Green got on him. Has a little bit different release, but is really accurate. And keep in mind, two more years in this system if he plays out his eligibility.
Right. Hey, you mentioned Florida Atlantic, one of the teams that really got on him hard. Little trivia question for you. You know who's coaching there right now, right?
Howard Schnellenberg.
That's right. Oh, that's easy for you. I'm sorry.
Oh,
I'm sorry.
Challenge me a little bit.
Oh, boy.
Now.
You looked at me with disdain, like, what?
Oh, you got to challenge me a little bit there. I mean,
PJ Lane.
This is one of those basketball games now.
I know. Hey, Holly, break this up for me, would you please?
Don't make me come up there. Omar Jacobs had a pretty interesting recruiting experience. And, guys, imagine his recruiting trip. He gets an offer late to go up to Bowling Green on a Monday and Tuesday afternoon. He's from Delray, Florida. He goes up. It's freezing cold. He steps off the plane in a little jean jacket. He said they were quickly able to give him a coat that he was able to borrow, but he said even though it was cold and not really his style of place, he loved the family atmosphere of the players. He said they were so kind, so gracious. It was like a family, and he's glad he's joined it.
And he's a big part of it right now for the future.
I know Urban Meyer, the coat off his back he gave to Omar Jacobs when he got out of
literally
it. Oh yeah, yeah, he knew. He knew. He was actually looking at another guy down in Florida, got the phone call from Kansas State. And Greg Brandon, got to give him a lot of credit, came to Bowling Green 4 years ago with Urban Meyer, was the offensive coordinator, really put this offense in, and he has definitely kept going what he and Urban Meyer started 4 years ago.
Thing is rolling right now, and an early Christmas present for Bowling Green State University. Don't forget SportsCenter coming up next. Got a fumble down there. And Memphis has recovered. So the Scrooge showed up, albeit a little bit late in the ballgame for Bowling Green. And with mention of Christmas, Bob, I want to wish both you and Holly a very Merry Christmas. And there's his Christmas present. Coach Brandon got it.
Tell you what, he got it square on that time.
Ran a little misdirection on it. Don't forget, coming up next on SportsCenter, Allen Iverson is going to drop another 50. He's had two consecutive 50-point games, a rematch of Indiana and Detroit. That one coming up. And who got snubbed for the Pro Bowl? Some interesting selections. And what about all the Philadelphia Eagles going? First down and 10. Of course, the most prominent one won't be, or might not be anyway, the result of his injury. And Memphis gives it right back. The pick by Keon Newsom. Newsom led the team this year with 5 picks. That's number 6. And he shows you why he's all MAC. It comes from some good bloodlines. His brother, Kendall, plays in the NFL.
Sorry, Mark, you're exactly right. This guy wants to be a pro bass fisherman. And I mean, Holly had him put on a clinic the other night when we visited about all the different bait. And it was a pretty impressive conversation. You didn't know that, did you?
No, the fishing
pro
thing?
Bass fishing.
You got me on that one. Be on Bass Center. We have a new show coming up on ESPN. Don't forget the Sports Center is coming up next. 52-35, and DeAngelo Williams will walk off and ponder his future with that injured fibula. Just when you think you have reached the end of your football rope, just tie a knot and hang.
Now, do you think my prediction will hold true through these 28 bowl games? Do you think that 87 points will be the most scored in all bowl games?
I don't know. That Louisville one's going to be pretty interesting. They can put them up too.
You're right. Exactly.
But I'll say that this one stays at the highest. I got to stick with you. You're my partner. 52-35, the final score. Delray Beach, Florida, the Bowling Green State University. Jacobs, the man tonight. 52-35, the final for Bowling Green. Coming up next at SportsCenter. There's been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. For more, log on to ESPN.com. Yeah, it's all orange. For Bob Davey, Holly Rowe, Phil Orlin, our producer, Bruce Troit, our director, and the rest of our talented gang, I'm Mark Jones saying so long from Mobile. SportsCenter, next.